This is a Headgum podcast.
Cold turkey may be great on sandwiches, but there's a better way to break your bad habits. We're not talking about some weird mind voodoo from your crazy neighbor or eccentric relatives. We're talking about our sponsor, Fume. And they look at the problem in a different way. Not everything in a bad habit is wrong, so instead of a drastic, uncomfortable change, why not just remove the bad from your habit? Fume is an innovative, award-winning flavored air device that does just that. Instead of vapor, Fume uses flavored air. Instead of electronics, Fume is completely natural. And instead of harmful chemicals, Fume uses delicious flavors. You get it. Instead of bad, Fume is good. It's a habit you're free to enjoy and makes replacing your bad habit easy. Your Fume comes with an adjustable airflow dial and is designed with movable parts and magnets for fidgeting, giving your fingers a lot to do, which is helpful for de-stressing and anxiety while breaking your habit. I gotta say, this thing, it feels very fresh. I mean, think of refreshing herbal tea. If vapor was compared to sticky soda, Fume flavors would compare to herbal tea, not as sweet and a lot more natural. It's well-weighted, it's perfectly balanced, and extremely fun to fidget with. And the real wood is beautiful, and the shape is pristine. You're going to feel cool using this. Stopping is something we all put off because it's hard, but switching to Fume is easy, enjoyable, and even fun. Fume has served over 150,000 customers and has thousands of success stories, and there's no reason that can't be you. Join Fume in accelerating humanity's breakup from destructive habits by picking up the Journey Pack today. Head to tryfume.com and use code Doughboys to save 10% off when you get the Journey Pack today. That's tryfume.com and use code Doughboys to save an additional 10% off your order today. He weighed 119 pounds, and 19 of those pounds were cock. Countless versions of this quote have been documented, said by screen legend Ava Gardner in reference to her third husband, the anatomically blessed Frank Sinatra. Born in 1915 in Hoboken, New Jersey, with effectively two umbilical cords, by the 1930s, Sinatra was regularly delighting nightclub crowds with his massive hog. During World War II, this diminutive pipe swinger whipped his built-in jump rope to the top of the charts, as screaming Bobby Soxer women and hooting USO troops turned out by the thousands to get a glimpse of his jaw-dropping and throat-widening donger. Nicknamed the Chairman of the Board, Old Blue Eyes, and the Cervix Destroyer, in the late 1940s, Sinatra teamed up with fellow hogsmen Dean Martin, Sammy Davis Jr., Peter Lawford, and Joey Bishop to form the original supergroup, the Rat Pack, named for the front-facing rat tails packed by these huge dick circus freaks. These five fuck machines collaborated on tours, Vegas reviews, and films, including the original Ocean's 11, a film based on the length of Sinatra's hog. And it's during the heyday of the Rat Pack that you'd find Sinatra at the oldest restaurant in Hollywood, handlessly touching the water in the men's room toilet. Sinatra was one of countless showbiz regulars who frequented the legendary steakhouse, where he'd hold court for hours, regaling celebrities like Marlon Brando and Orson Welles with glimpses of his big hog. Unfortunately for Sinatra, his peak in the 40s and 50s gave way to the 60s and 70s, when rock and roll introduced audiences to edgier, more innovative hogs. By the glam era of the 1980s, Americans were more interested in frizzy pubes than giant peens. But then, in 1993, just a few years before his death, Sinatra released his comeback hit entitled Duets, which explored a new aspect of his hog, his balls. It proved a fitting capstone for his ability to evolve as a meat marvel for six underwear-stretching decades. Sinatra died in 1998 at the age of 82, and his remains were preserved in two urns, one for his body and one for his big hog. But still today, 25 years after his death, this legendary Italian-American is fondly remembered for his staggering power tool that had the length and circumference of a tennis ball can. He also apparently was a singer. And also still today, if you hit up Frank's favorite Los Angeles steakhouse, you can sit in the Sinatra booth, where his prize hog once rested coiled on the cushions like a just-fed cobra. This week, on the final new Doughboys of 2023, we return to Steak and Shake via the oldest restaurant in Hollywood, Musso and Frank. Welcome to Doughboys, the podcast about chain restaurants. I'm Nick Weiger, along with my co-host,
the living embodiment of a Weeble, the Spoon Man, Mike Mitchell.
That's how you want to end the last, the start the last episode of the year?
Weebles wobbles, but they don't fall down.
Mm. Well,
now you like it.
It kind of hits close to home, I'll tell you. We'll get into that a little later.
That's from Robert in Des Moines, who dubs himself the mayor of Mayochup. Thanks for all the laughs. Always feel sarcastic when that's sent in to us. RoastSpoonMan@gmail.com.
The mayor of Mayochup?
The mayor of Mayochup.
I don't think he has to worry about anyone else donning themselves the mayor of Mayochup.
Well, we've already got our buddy Griffin is the king of Cranch, of course. Griffin Newman from Blank Check.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which, but Mayochup perhaps is unclaimed.
Mayochup, ketchup and mayo, basically. I feel like it would be
I think it's like ketchup and mayo. Just trying to Yeah, that's probably what it is.
I don't know. Hey, who knows? But
we don't know for sure.
We don't know for sure if it's ketchup and mayo, but a good combo, I guess, right? Like, I don't think it's a combo that I want to make.
Fuck, I just spilled.
Wow, he spilled. How bad was
it? Sorry, it's not that bad. Sorry, hold on.
Well, I guess it
looked you're going to spill again.
Hold on.
So, Mitch, how are you? It's me, Evan Susser. I am joining you guys as I do at the end of every year.
Mm-hmm.
I'm here.
It's the year-end episode, a little chaotic start. I was late there's a bunch of different...
Do you want to get into your health issues?
Well, yeah, I do want to get into my health issues, but I thought we would work our way into it.
Nah, let's start right away.
We're going to start right away into my health issues? Yeah, while
cleans up the spill.
So, you know, earlier...
I shouldn't have had three beverages in here. That's my fault.
Yeah,
that's
hubris.
100%. I got a coffee, I got a Coke Zero, and I got a bottle of water.
At least the Coke Zero isn't opened.
Not yet. And thank you, Emma. Thank you, Emma, for being on the ball with the paper towels.
Of course.
She knows who she's working with.
Tissues, Kleenex, you're over the Doughboys.
Imodium, all of the important things.
Emma, hit him with a drop.
Oh, shit. I was getting paper towels. I wasn't ready.
Oh, shit.
Hold on. I got it. It's good. We're almost there. Here it is.
I didn't want to do it. We did it, but I didn't want
to. You wanted to.
You wanted to.
That's not true. Yeah, you did. You said Spotify is getting too much criticism from people.
You wanted to. Here you go, create another single.
You wanted to. You wanted to. You wanted to.
Why'd you leave the keys up on the table?
You wanted to.
Why don't think you trust?
I like that one.
That's you.
It's me.
It features our guest and System of a Down, who I don't think has been represented in a drop before.
Mm-hmm. This is the drop for Sus's Ep. I shouldn't say where we went yet. I guess who cares?
It's in the episode description.
Yeah,
it's in the
drop
intro.
For the Musso and Frank Grill with Evan Susser episode. Hello, I'm a high school English teacher in rural Virginia.
Wow!
Thank you for your service.
And you make my days easier.
Wow!
Thanks for all the laughs, Ben. December 16th, 2022.
Wow, one year ago.
A year ago.
Wow. Yeah.
Look,
Ben is still listening to the podcast and hasn't left the profession.
That's I agree. I hope everything's good with Ben. I
teachers get burned out. It's a tough job.
It's not easy.
Yeah.
I come from a family of teachers.
Yeah, especially with like these woke rules about the curriculum.
Uh-oh. Doughboys becomes way more profitable on Patreon immediately.
Let's just say I got some old versions of Huck Finn I keep on standby.
Jesus.
Why? Can't say that?
No.
I was trying to think of the controversial books. I couldn't think of any.
It's not good.
All right, fine. Edit point. Wags, I come from a whole family of teachers.
That's right.
My dad was a teacher before he was a lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
My
dad taught college chemistry.
Oh, yeah.
Do you consider yourself a teacher in a way as a podcaster?
I did. I have taught some improv classes before, so I feel like that does count in many ways. But no, the answer is no.
Okay.
It's been a bad year. I called it a piss year at one point.
You did, okay. You have been calling it a piss year, and you've been trying to get me on board with it being a piss year. I've been a little bit more positive about it, even though I don't think it's been good, but I don't know if I would designate it a piss year.
Yeah, I'd say it's a piss year for me. And look, a lot of good stuff happened.
That's right.
Twisted Metal came out.
Mm-hmm.
Wags.
That's right. Mitch's, for people who are audio listeners, Mitch is unbuttoning his flannel to reveal a Twisted Metal t-shirt, a thing you would not have been able to do just a few short weeks ago when the SAG-AFTRA strike was still ongoing.
And Wags...
Buttoning it back up?
It's, well, yeah, I guess I should probably leave it. I didn't get to say then.
Yeah.
That it was, I mean, like, you should watch Twisted Metal. It's on Peacock.
On Peacock.
Now, streaming on Peacock.
That's right.
And it was one of the most fun things I ever got to do in my life when I was down there in New Orleans. I had a blast doing it, and I think it's a great show.
And you're great in it.
You're great in it.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I was very excited about it. And then, so look, some of, you know, the strike, it was just bad timing, but that's okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's champagne problems, as they say.
Mm-hmm. Or stair problems. What?
Sure, it's stair problems. But speaking of stair problems, stuff going on in my house, you know, the ceiling's collapsing. Maybe
what?
Maybe there's a little bit of a, you know, maybe this little townhouse of mine is a lemon.
Santa Landis lay up there? Weighed down with all your presents.
It's not the roof. It's the
oh, it's the, one of the internal
ceiling. It's on one of the stair levels.
Right. Yes. Yeah.
But look, champagne problems again. Whatever.
Yeah.
I'm lucky to have a place. I'm lucky to have a home.
That's good. Yeah.
Everything
that's
going
right.
on in the world is bad, that's but true. You know, some people I love going through a lot of stuff. Whatever. Right. It's been the year has been. There's been some highs and lows. And
I didn't realize how much coffee I got on my pants.
Jesus Christ. Why did you want me to start the show?
Keep going.
Why did you want me to start the show with my stuff? I don't understand.
I thought it would be a good juxtaposition of Weiger cleaning up a spill and you talking about... Because the stuff, the health stuff, I thought could be too heavy. So I thought him still dealing with the spill would maybe just kind of balance it out a little comedy.
So stuff that show. Stuff is too heavy. I can't make any jokes. You get mad at my jokes.
I am here to be positive. Should I give my mission statement today?
No.
Wait, did you credit the dropper? We could the teacher from Virginia, Ben.
Yes.
That's right. That's right. So we should introduce our guest.
I already did it while you were gone.
Our guest today, the commissioner of the Doughboys Tournament of Champions, Evan Susser, is back. Hi, Evan.
Hey, good to be here, guys. We're off to a great start.
It's going great.
Can I tell the fucking thing?
Please.
So, you know, stuff builds up like it always does, and there's things, you know, whatever, and overwhelmed, and I start to ask myself, you know, why do I everything I do goes wrong? You know what I mean? I feel that way.
I don't think that's true. Yeah.
I know, it's not true. It's not true, but I started to feel that way quite a bit.
Kirby shirt, too. Sorry.
So I said, at one point I said...
You want a shout wipe?
I would like a shout wipe.
Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Emma. So yeah, so anyway, keep going.
At one point, I was dealing with sleep issues. I wasn't sleeping well.
You might
well.
Want to use a shower wipe on your pants too.
I
in addition
know.
To the shirt. Okay. Sorry, go ahead, Mitch.
It's just this that's not gonna it's not gonna stain as bad. The shirt's light color.
Yeah. Anyway, go ahead, Mitch.
No. I'm done. I'm not gonna say it.
I was just trying to help him out with this bill.
I'm not gonna fucking say it.
Thank you, Emma. Go on, Mitch. We care about you. We want to hear what you're saying. Please go ahead.
So
please
at one point, I wanted to get my sleep stuff under wraps, and
that's right.
And why? Because I was talking to a doctor, and you said, and I this doctor got suggested to me, and I was like, I don't know if I should go to this guy. And you said you should do it. My mom said I should do it. So I went.
I also said you should do it.
Sus also did say I should do it. So I went to the doctor, and he said we gotta get you a sleep study. I did a sleep study. And I've talked about this on the podcast, but every minute of every hour I was waking up with the CPAP.
Right.
So it wasn't a good
result.
Getting
restful sleep.
Wasn't getting restful sleep. So I started to use the CPAP at about the beginning of October.
Did you see that Emma gave you a Tide pen?
I did see that too, but I think it might be overkill for the show.
Sorry, go ahead, Mitch.
Thank you.
Fuck you, first of all.
What? I'm trying to help him with
your little bullshit at the beginning of...
No, I'm here to be nice. I'm sorry.
So, I started using the CPAP. Jesus Christ. I mean, he's doing a lot over there. I started using the CPAP.
Yeah.
About 2 weeks after using the CPAP in October, I got sick with some sort of virus. I don't know what it was.
It's really good because you said CPAC instead of CPAP. That's a very different thing.
CPAP,
yeah.
CPAP.
Again, Patreon exploded. For a mention of CPAP.
So I started using it, and you maybe heard me saying how I thought my house was haunted on
there.
That's
right.
Not a good sign.
No.
I was maybe a little paranoid.
Mm-hmm.
My anxiety spiked.
Right.
I'm going to be open and talk about this stuff because we talk about everything on this podcast. But my anxiety spiked. I was so jumpy. I was paranoid. I thought someone was in my house. This is all real.
Yeah.
I didn't know what was wrong with me. It was very, very, very scary. Especially when I realized that I had some sort of something happened. There was something going on that I wasn't in control of or whatever. So I at least realized that. My mom was coming out luckily anyway, since she came out and she's a lifesaver and I love her. And I guess I'm on steroids. I'm on my last round of steroids today.
Yeah, you're looking huge.
It was either the virus like set me off or there's a million things it could be, but I also read that the CPAP can like fuck with your inner ear stuff and that like fucks you up. I went to the doctor. I take eye drops now. It was like a million different things, but it was a terrifying. It was the most scared about my health I've ever been in my entire life I got like extreme brain fog for 4 straight weeks. Like I woke up.
Jeez. And you're usually razor sharp. What? You are.
That was good.
You're one of the quickest, funniest guys I know.
All right. I had thank you, sus. For a month straight, I was waking up every day with brain fog. And I was dizzy. I was almost falling over. It was very strange.
Yeah.
It was all very strange. I also was only paranoid for like 2 days. And that's also when I was like, wait a minute, something is wrong.
Right.
You know, I thought the house was haunted.
Yeah.
Well, look, Mitch, I'm happy to hear you're doing better. Weiger and I have both, of course, heard this before. So maybe that's why I'm being a little glib. But I am very happy to hear you're doing better.
Yeah.
Obviously, that's very scary.
Mm-hmm.
Weiger, I'm glad you were able to clean up your stain. Yeah. And I'm really excited to be here.
Great to have you.
A year-end tradition. It's something to look forward to. What?
You thought this stuff was too heavy. You wanted me to start the show off with it. You pinned me into saying it. You made jokes the entire fucking time I was talking about it. Maybe I am still a little kooky. Maybe you should be fucking nervous. Fucking asshole.
He's on the roids.
Yeah.
The roid rage.
I have steroids and maybe I'm a fucking loose cannon now.
Look. I don't want to fall into these patterns, the year-end episode. I don't want to get into fighting. I want this to be positive. I've come here as a positive force.
I'm still foggy today, just to let people know. I've gotten better.
Yeah.
But I'm still scared. I'm going to the doctor on Monday. It's been a long road. And look, it's that sort of thing, too, of like, I think a lot of stuff just piles up. It's been a tough year.
Right.
But it is a celebration.
Yes, it has been a tough year, but I will say, we've been doing these year-end episodes a lot.
That's right.
And every episode, I think, starts with a lament about how it's a bad year, how it's a piss year. And, you know, they can't all be bad years. You know, there have to be some that are better. And I think if you look back
at the time
that you've been doing this podcast, look at all of the things in your life that have happened. You've had all these exciting acting career developments. You've been in movies. Ew. You've been in television shows. You have a house that's falling apart, but still, it's great. And you've built this podcast, which has a huge following, which you're able to, you know, do and bring so much joy to people. And that's happened along the way in all of these years that you've said have all been bad years. So, you know, hey, maybe there's another way to look at it. Maybe there's been some positive.
It's a good attitude.
Yeah.
I'm positive now.
I'm positive too. And look, like I said, the Twisted Metal is one of the most fun things. And I can promote it now.
Yeah.
And maybe at the end of the episode, maybe there'll be a little something fun. A little
wow.
something.
Ooh, okay.
You're alluding to something.
A little tease.
Yeah.
Great.
Is that all you had to say?
About my positivity?
Yeah.
No, I guess I can get into some of those. So I thought.
Well, did you have more to say about your health? You're doing better.
I'm doing better.
Yeah.
I'm trending towards good, but it's been like a while now, 5 or 6 weeks of I did think my house was haunted, which I know is silly. I know that's a silly part of the story, but I had never...
I mean, it depends on what... I mean, if in Haunted Mansion, yeah, it's silly. But like, you know...
I'm saying...
Last house on the left, a little not as fun.
That's a little spookier. That was... I mean, it was more that like...
Yeah.
I was seeing lines and like I was having vision problems.
Sure.
So it was like... I also now don't want people to think that I'm crazy because I'm not, but I was dealing with some stuff that was fucking me
I think
up.
That you have the self-awareness to acknowledge it and to say that you, to discuss and the openness to discuss it will be, let people be like, oh, I don't, you know, I think people will feel good for you.
Can I tell you the bit that I did? What were you going to ask?
Did you think that this is going to sound like a joke, but I'm actually curious. Did you think the devil was behind it?
I'll say this. Around Halloween, I said, like, the devil doesn't scare me that much anymore. Yeah. And I said, the exorcist isn't scary anymore. That's out the window. Yeah, I'm now more scared of the devil than I've ever been, and I believe that he is real, and I'm scared of him.
Okay.
So that
even though you realize that you're being paranoid,
I realized that I was being paranoid, but still, look, it came back for me. Did look when I was kooky, when I was like in my worst state? Did I? What's it called?
You said this in the podcast before.
Yeah.
You got. I mean, you said this maybe last week or 2 weeks ago. You got yeah.
Well, what is
holy
what is,
water?
Sage. I saged my house.
Yeah, you said this. You said this.
Did I use holy water in my house? Yes. Was that me at the height of my kookiness? Yeah, probably. Am I still now afraid of the devil more than I've ever been? Yes. Mm-hmm. It goes. And do I also realize that I was being that I had like something was going on with whatever was happening? The doctor also said it might be that I'm getting oxygen, which is you'll laugh it up with this one, but I'm getting oxygen to my brain for the first time.
I was ready to not laugh at that, but it was funny.
he's like, you haven't gotten oxygen to your brain, and also he thinks it's from the virus. He thinks that it was like results from the virus. But I just want to say the bit I did to you guys was funny.
Oh yeah, that was
which
funny.
I was like, hey, I just want to let you guys know that I've been like going through some mental health stuff, and I said like a full spiel. And you guys are like, oh no, that's too bad. Sorry. And then I just I copied and pasted that and put it again.
Yeah, so you said it to us again
the next day.
Yeah. I said it to you again the next day.
Does he not know that he told us this already?
No, that's good.
I did it a few times. It was a fun bit. But I'm feeling good. I'm feeling better.
That's great.
It was scary. It came out of nowhere. That's what scared me about it. And that's why I think that it was related to the CPAP or the virus. But
or maybe you doubting the devil.
Or it could be that, and now I don't doubt the Exorcist. It wins scariest movie again. I'm scared of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
it could be a combination of stuff, but I'm still cloudy. I'm almost it's gotten better where I was like so heavily cloudy every day, and now I'm like I don't. But all the other stuff, there's been a lot of other stuff, but there has been good things.
Sure,
yeah,
there's been good stuff.
There's been great stuff, that leads me to my positive attitude and what I'm thinking. So here. Last year, when I came for the year-end episode, I came in with my grievances, and we kind of fallen into the pattern that these year-end episodes are all about, like, stirring stuff up and getting into fights, and it kind of last year felt like with an icky taste. It didn't come off well, and...
I think people were just mad at you,
kind of. They kind of were, and I didn't like that.
Yeah.
And then, you guys, I don't mean to bring this up, but it's in the purpose of being positive, you guys attempted to record a 400th episode earlier this year.
Mm-hmm.
Which did not go well. Then you guys brought me back to kind of, you know, first of all, just to be on a 400th episode because you decided not to release that episode.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And I kind of came to be peacekeeper to kind of, you know, and just have a fun episode. It was,
that's right.
You know, we talked about ice cream and that was great. And I said, I enjoy that so much more to be a positive force. And so I was thinking about what I was going to do when I came on this time. And I said, I should be a positive force again and really help celebrate Doughboys with you guys. So I've got something planned, and right now I'm gonna call in Amelia Marino, who's gonna help me out, help start us off. So is Amelia, is she out there?
We can get her.
Amelia, is she out there? Everyone's in the room. What the oh my god,
wow.
I'm here.
Wow.
Okay, so
you got Amelia to dress up in a suit instead of yourself.
Well, yes. You know, actually, I went to Amelia because I'm not musical. And I think in the Doughboys tradition, you guys, when there's like a big event, it's nice to have something musical. And I asked Amelia if she could write a song to kind of celebrate the Doughboys. I haven't heard this, but I'm really excited to hear it. And she's going to kind of start us off with a little song to get us going.
Amelia, I should describe for audio listeners, dressed to the nines, has a nice slacks, a shirt and tie, red tie, and is it a pinstripes blazer? How would you describe that?
Yes.
Or those chalk stripes?
A classic crooner outfit, you may say.
Oh, how about
that's
that?
A hint of I the feel kind so of bad song. That. It's gonna be
as you were because you came to the door and you're like, "What's up?" and you were dressed normally, and then when you left, I texted you, "You don't have to put my salad in the fridge." You were desperately changing into this clothes.
Yeah, actually, desperately looking for my phone. So let's hope I remember these lyrics.
Yeah. you want to get your phone?
I lost my phone.
Go get your phone.
Do you want my phone?
I'll take Saucer's phone. It's okay.
All right, so this is the...
Hold on, do we need to put on headphones?
Yeah, we do.
Okay, we'll get some headphones on. Okay, we took a quick break because Emma thought that Susser was going to bring this out during the segment.
That's and my bad. That's my
so
bad.
We all had to get headphones on, so we took a second to cover that. But we're back now.
This is a positive thing, Weiger. We're celebrating Doughboys.
Uh-huh.
There's no need to pick up. There are going to be some bumps in the road.
Yeah, it's fine. We're just acknowledging the jump cut.
This is great.
It's all going to be okay.
Okay.
It's fine. It's going to be great.
All right. A musical celebration to Doughboys from Amelia. Again, I've not heard this, but I'm excited to hear.
Wow.
So your thing this year was to have Amelia make something?
There's more.
Okay.
Ready?
Yep. Ooh. And now year end is here.
This is beautiful.
And so a rest from podcast burden. My friends, I'll make it clear. There are complaints. I've been observing. You've talked a lot of cum, devoured each and every entree, left people bored, more bored than this, 'cause it was okay. Regrets, you've had a lot. But now a lot I'm going to mention. Let's start with a guest named Lo, or Koalic, or EP400. You ate at lousy chains like Taco John's or Shaq's or Subway. You gorged on chips, and it was okay. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when you bit off more than you could chew, but through it all, and it felt okay. For what are two men with a dumb pod eating themselves closer to God to say the things they truly feel about? And that is okay.
Wow. Lovely pipes.
So that was a musical tribute was a musical tribute to Doughboys.
Wow.
It had a little more shots and negativity than I was expecting and trying to keep
it positive.
Well,
it seems like you wrote it and then had Amelia sing it maybe to seem like you weren't really...
No. But
can I
think
see the lyrics for a second?
Oh, yeah, of course.
I just want to see. Here, you're gonna have to. Oh, it's your phone.
It's phone.
Here, you're gonna have to open that.
Little Frank Sinatra, by the way, who you did, you could not have known this. I mentioned in my intro.
Oh, I thought I was doing Seth MacFarlane.
You thought that was a Seth MacFarlane original?
I watched the Sing cover to prepare for this.
Oh my God!
He was like, from the movie
I'm
Sing.
I'm just a mouse.
Or wow!
What is a mouse?
From Illumination Sing, Seth MacFarlane's rendition of My Way. That was your context for that song.
Yes.
So guys, keep the headphones on.
Okay.
Because what we're gonna do now is I put it
low.
I cautiously
Rob Lowe, I just
wrote. Put it to the Doughboys Reddit. And said, what are some of the silliest clips and funniest clips from Doughboys that just make you laugh?
Mm-hmm.
And we're just going to listen to a selection of clips and just kind of talk about, you know, how you think about them.
All right.
And we're going to have, so let's start with this first clip. I don't want to introduce it. We'll just hear what it is.
Okay.
See if we can identify it. Emma, can you hit it?
Take two. Emma, keep this in.
All right.
It's Austin Powers. It's Austin Powers. It's Austin Powers. It's Austin Powers.
Can we guess what this
is? It's Austin Powers. It's Austin Powers. It's Austin Powers.
My guess is that it's Austin Powers.
It's Austin Powers. We're gonna guess what the sauce is. It's Austin Powers.
We should have brought that back.
Yeah, why haven't we done Austin Powers again?
To me, that just is such a great example of the fun of Doughboys.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if you remember. The way it started out is you were going to do Austin Powers, but you just played the song.
Right.
Just as is. And Mitch said, you didn't write lyrics. And he said, well, there aren't lyrics to the original song. Why would I do parodies? But you got on board and you came up with that great thing. Someone on, you know, Reddit said that they still sing that to themselves every day.
Wow.
Wow.
What
the fuck is this?
And
Are they on death row?
I thought that was... I thought that was a lot of fun. We're going to go... Do you guys have any reaction hearing that song again?
I'd completely forgotten about it, but then hearing it, I was like, oh yeah, we did do Austin Powers, and I was like, we should do the Austin Powers segment again. Mm-hmm. That was a good segment.
Yeah.
Great. Well, I love that. Let's keep it going. We have another, I mean, musical segments are such a great part of the show.
It's true.
We have another great.
As we just witnessed.
Yes. We have another great musical clip that people also commented as just a really fun moment. It's a little abridged, but I think it's great. Okay. Let's hear that again. Emma, when you're ready.
Ketchup or mustard, choose one, then you can't squeeze it in your bun. That's how the game works.
I sound like shit, is what I
think. You sound great.
Thank you, everyone.
The listeners all feel sad. This podcast sucks.
I guess it's a little negative.
Yeah.
But it's still.
I mean, I remember my sacrifice.
Yeah.
We sacrificed ketchup or mustard.
He sacrificed a couple things.
I just want to move back to Quincy.
Oh, I guess it's kind of negative.
Yeah, yeah.
Really negative.
I don't know if it's that negative. I feel like it might be a good idea.
Our sacrifice.
Anyone singing that still?
Wow.
We lost
Weiger. I think he quit intentionally, is my guess.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
This is what happened.
Me?
We were doing that one on Zoom.
Oh, God.
We were doing that one on stream.
Oh, yeah. I guess it was kind of
my
bad.
Internet connection.
End, so I think he saw most of it.
I did watch that later, but my internet connection.
I wrote the whole song.
Yeah.
Who was the guest?
I think it was John Daly.
It was Van.
It was Van.
And
we did the segment
Bugman.
With John Daly earlier, though.
Yes, you've done it twice. You did the full one, and then you was very impressive, the song, but Weiger didn't hear it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it seems like you picked two things, or at least this one is pretty negative.
Right.
No. I mean, it's still fun. It's still a fun song.
Yeah, it was a fun moment.
Okay, well, I think the next one is just pure fun. It's not going to happen.
That is also one of the most epic parody songs I think you've done. You did the full song. You wrote the entire three. The whole thing is like 5 minutes long. That's why we had to abridge it.
That's insane.
Well, let's
keep have any. Do you think we have any listeners on death row? You made me think of that.
I don't know if you can listen to podcasts on death row. How would you? Because I don't think you have a phone.
Well, how about the music label?
Yeah.
Do you think we have any listeners who are on Death Row, the music label?
Yeah, probably.
Is it still in operation?
I don't know if Death Row Records still exists.
Still, yeah, I don't think it still exists.
Okay, this next clip is just fun. So let's play that.
You know what doesn't suck, Mitch?
Oh, there's video too.
What's that, Nick?
Okay.
Our very first Doughboys guest, but also you didn't say Heidi Ho to Spoon Nation, did you?
I didn't. No, not in the howdy home. What's you still this? Haven't addressed.
Oh, shit, I didn't do it today either.
I thought we weren't going to talk about it on pod.
Oh, you my think we God. You're a piece about of it shit. On pod?
Well, it seemed like you were just here? An hour-ing through it mode.
Are you wearing the same shirt?
Does it look like I'm in
I am wearing the same
mode?
Shirt. Yeah, and also, I'm like, I look thinner.
Do you think you
thinner.
Were maybe a little mean?
What are you talking about?
Do you think that you maybe you were mean?
No, I don't. I think you were talking shit, and I think I retaliated.
Okay.
That's my perception of it. Also, I think that it was a little more playful than you perceived.
Has anyone ever seen this before?
I think.
You know what else?
What?
Is this from the Lost episode of
Doughboys? Yeah,
it's
a Dairy Queen.
Yeah, it's from the fucking Lost episode, you fucking dickhead. Yeah.
How did this get mixed up?
Did I send
the wrong time code or
did
something?
Did I pull from the wrong 400?
Oh, jeez.
I got an idea, Wags. I have a great bonding idea. We kick the shit out of it.
Okay, look. 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 That was a mistake. Maybe something I could have, but look, you got to mix it up. You got to have a little bit of, just like patting yourselves on the back.
I like that you're leaning into your villain.
A little negativity.
Okay.
Next, we have, we're going to get back to positive, Philadelphia Cream Cheese. You know that song?
Oh, great song.
Of course.
Great song. We have the video of that from, not from the official Doughboy source, but from a listener.
Fan took it in the audience at our Philadelphia
We're
going to
watch
show.
A little bit
oh, great.
Of Philadelphia Cream Cheese.
All right, let's watch that. That's fun.
Also, we didn't
Sorry.
We didn't order lunch in advance, which I wanted to do.
Oh, my God. Blood sugar's going to plummet.
Yeah.
I could talk to a dog and get you a fucking piece of dog shit, you fucking asshole. How's that for a lunch snack, you fucking dickhead?
Man. You know, I had not seen the video, actually, until now. I had only heard it.
It's still funny.
It's still very, it's very angry funny. when you look at it.
Yeah, I was fucking angry.
Let me just, like, review what I've pulled, actually.
Okay.
Well.
Amelia, you have a musical theater background?
I've done a couple of the musicals in high school and college, but.
I got bad news.
Yeah.
I don't know how this happened, but I'm reviewing my notes. My next thing is actually not a clip from the show. It's actually a voice memo.
Oh, wow. Okay.
That Mitch sent me after or right around the time of recording the
Jesus
episode 400.
Oh, wow.
Where I don't think no one's heard this. This is him kind of this is how he talks. Not on the air.
Got
this
it.
Is not fun, Mitch. This is just the real. I don't know if we should play this. This is maybe bad. This is, again, I wanted to come here as a positive force.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And this is just, this is maybe going to cross the line of not even being.
I say we play it and we can always cut it.
You want to play it okay, and we good. Could.
Yeah,
Mitch, is it okay
it.
If we
yeah,
play
we
it?
Yeah, we can play it. Let's hear it.
Okay, let's play it.
Please welcome live via
Wait, what's this?
Zoom.
Yelling at his children or his child that the show is about to begin. It's the Noid.
It's the Noid. Wow.
Wow. Welcome, Noid.
I'm going to stand for the anthem.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed as the twilight last gleaming? Whose bold stripes and bold scars through the perilous fight? For the rampart we won. The bulls bursting in air. It blew through the night that our food was still there. Bulls stayed up in our spangled bowler yet Let's
thank you, the Noid. Feel the Noid. Better. All right.
It might have been another the funniest our podcast ever was.
Yeah, I think that's the peak. That's
all of our that's all of the clip review.
I totally forgot that Kowalik changed it to bowl lyrics. it was the bowl national anthem because it was for a bowl tournament.
Well, guys, I'm sorry that there were some so flub funny. Ups in that clip show.
I can't believe those flubs happened.
I know. Yeah, really,
so random. Mean,
do you really have a voicemail from the time that happened?
No, I don't.
Oh, man. I kind of was interested in hearing what it was.
But I thought that was fun to look back at some great moments in Doughboys. It's not just the fighting, which, yes, there is some fighting, but there's also a lot of great, silly, fun stuff that I thought we should celebrate. The Noid singing the national anthem.
Great. Our buddy Matt Kowalik.
Yeah.
I mean. Who had COVID at the time.
Who did have COVID. Zoom. Yeah. He was
and Amelia, I thought the song was fantastic.
Great song, Amelia.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Very well done.
Thank you.
Did Susser tell you to dress up in a suit or rosette?
No, this is all me.
All right, that's
good. I think
good.
It was the right call.
I texted like 100 people asking if they had a fedora, and nobody did, so.
I guess that means you know the right people.
Yeah, I guess so.
And to be clear, you were dressing up as Seth MacFarlane,
yes.
I guess?
Or the mouse.
Or the mouse and sing.
You usually are in a suit for the...
Not for the end of the year.
Oh, okay.
That's true.
Only,
yeah.
You know,
usually
for
the tournament.
Tournament
of champions.
You wore a suit last night. I'll say that.
Yeah.
Well, look, we got to get into last night. Here's what we should do. If we're done with the clips.
Yes, we're done with the clips.
Let's move on to the chips, if you will. Let's take a break. We'll be right back with more Doughboys.
This show is sponsored by BetterHelp. You know, our family doesn't really exchange a lot of gifts. We're more focused on enjoying time together. And whether or not your family gives gifts during the holidays, you get to define how you give to yourself. And the holidays are a great time to do just that. So whether it's starting therapy, going easier on yourself during the tough moments, or treating yourself to a day of complete rest, remember to give yourself some love this holiday season. Me, I've benefited from therapy. It's helped me a lot. Just talking to somebody and working on my, you know, all my various issues. And also, it can be helpful for learning positive coping skills and how to set boundaries. It empowers you to be the best version of yourself, and it isn't just for those who've experienced major trauma. If you're thinking of starting therapy, give BetterHelp a try. It's entirely online, designed to be convenient, flexible, and suited to your schedule. Just fill out a brief questionnaire to get matched with a licensed therapist and switch therapists at any time for no additional charge. In the season of giving, give yourself what you need with BetterHelp. Visit BetterHelp.com/Doughboys today to get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/Doughboys. Last minute shoppers, you know how difficult and stressful it can be to find a great gift, especially as we get closer to the holidays and the stores start to look a little bare. Me, I always struggle to shop for the perfect gift. And I don't know what to do. Yeah, there's only so many things you can get a person, especially when they've already got a lot of stuff. But you know what? I can't wait to see my mom's face when she gets this frame. I loaded it with all of our favorite pics. Like us, having fun, and hanging out, and also being a family. I'm really excited to give this to my family and start sharing all these pictures with them. Luckily, you still have time to get a thoughtful personal gift for your loved ones. A digital picture frame from Aura Frames loaded up with all your favorite pics. It was named the number one digital frame by Wirecutter, The Strategist, and Wired. It'll be a nice surprise for whoever, mom, dad, grandma, a sibling. And it's the gift that keeps giving. Even after you hand it off, you can upload new photos from the Aura app and invite the rest of your family to do that too. And it's easy for grandma too. She can just swipe the top of the frame to get past all the photos everyone else has sent you and get to you. Save yourself the hassle of last-minute shopping. Give the perfect gift this holiday by visiting AuraFrames.com today and get $30 off their best-selling frames with the code Doughboys. These frames sell out quickly, though, so get yours before they're gone. That's AuraFrames.com with the promo code Doughboys. Terms and conditions apply.
Welcome back to Doughboys for our year-end episode, Steak and Shake 8.
Wow.
We're up at 8 already with our buddy Evan Susser.
So Steak and Shake 8... But it's 7 years, right? Because I
think 2015 we started.
2015. Wow.
Yeah.
Because didn't we do the first time we did Steak and Shake not at the end of the year? And then at the end of the year, we did
then
it again.
Then we went back. Yes. Right. Yeah. So we've covered Steak and Shake, quote unquote, Steak and Shake eight times.
Wow.
This is number eight. They haven't all been named in that, you know, same convention, but this is the eighth time we've done this. And we're covering for this week, for the steaks part, Musso and Frank Grill, which is the oldest restaurant in Hollywood. Founded in 1919, and the new room where we were sitting was constructed in 1955. So that's how much history there is.
And I got to say this.
Mm-hmm.
Sus had never been before.
That's right.
Never had been. It was a real treat.
Musso was in Frank Virgin.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
We should get ahead of this. Look, Musso and Frank's is a very nice restaurant. It's an expensive restaurant.
That's right.
It may seem out of touch or in bad form that this is where we're going to. We're going to tell you all about this like great fancy meal. But you know what? It was a delight. It was a thrill, and it was a real treat that you guys took me there.
I also think it's the kind of thing that we can use our show budget to cover a restaurant like this, because this is like an iconic Hollywood institution.
Yes.
Again, it's the oldest restaurant in Hollywood. It's the only restaurant with a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. It's been featured in many movies and TV shows, including Ocean's 11, Mad Men, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, Bosch, Ed Wood. There's just like the list of movies that have used this as a filming location and TV shows is a bunch of heavy hitters. And also their famous regulars included people like Charlie Chaplin, F. Scott Fitzgerald, Marilyn Monroe, Frank Sinatra, who we mentioned, Orson Welles.
One more that we can get to when we get into our meal.
That's right.
Should I say?
We should just say it.
Yeah. So when we sat at the table, our hostess said, "You are sitting at the Raymond Chandler table. Raymond Chandler sat right here in this booth and wrote The Big Sleep. And I put you guys here because I know you're here for the podcast, and that's what it makes me want to do when I listen to it." Have a big sleep.
Did she really say the other stuff to you?
The Raymond Chandler wrote The Big Sleep there.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And that she knew that it was for the podcast.
So. Yeah, we were in the Raymond Chandler booth.
Wait, she really knew it was for the podcast?
No, she didn't know. But yes, it was a Raymond Chandler, and he did write The Big Sleep there.
Wow.
Supposedly.
We should say that this is, so as far as what you're experiencing when you go into this place, it feels kind of frozen in time. It's like, you know, it's very, very old school. It feels like a restaurant from the 1920s from its heyday. And then there's also, that extends to the wait staff who are... you know, all wearing like blazers and, you know, like our server had like a red blazer with like a black trimming and like just look like everyone looks like they're out of a movie.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is there a chance you got a waiter who's a ghost? Possibly. You could never tell the difference. And that's not just me being crazy.
I was going to ask. Before we get into our meal, I looked this up and I thought this could be a fun mini game to play. I'm going to name some celebrities. Can you guess their favorite dish at Musso and Frank? These are some Hollywood regulars.
Wow.
Yeah.
I love this game.
First up, director Steven Soderbergh.
Soderbergh makes me think he wants a soda and a berg. A soda and a burger.
Wow.
I think it's going to be... a salad. I think it's going to be the Musso and Frank salad.
Steven Soderbergh likes the corned beef and cabbage.
Weird.
How about that?
Weird. I would have not guessed that.
The late, great Alan Arkin.
Arkin. I'm going to go with steak.
Okay. Steak is your guess.
I'm going to go with the boiled chicken.
That's a good guess, but he ended up really liking his go-to was the fried zucchini that he got for 50 years.
Wow.
Next up, Danny Trejo. Danny Trejo, a restaurateur in his own right. There are Trejo's Tacos, which we should probably review on the
donuts.
Podcast, and then Trejo's Coffee and Donuts. I've had both of them. He apparently goes once a week.
Once a week.
Yeah.
Wow, that kind of changes it. Yeah.
So because of that, I think he's got a little bit of a sweet tooth. I think that he likes the crepes, which maybe we ordered last night, which were called what?
They were called the griddle cakes?
Yeah, griddle cakes.
I think, you know, originally I was trying to be too cute.
Flannel cakes, I apologize.
Flannel cakes.
But I think I'm going to go straight down the middle, prime rib.
Chicken pot pie. This is the best chicken pot pie anywhere.
I should have gone with something weird.
That's one of the ones where it's like, it's a weekly special. Like, I think every Thursday they have chicken pot pie.
He goes once a weekend on the same day when they have it.
Special, yeah. Wow. All right, this is the last one. Keith Richards and Ronnie Wood of the Rolling Stones.
Oh, Keith Richards is in the Rolling Stones, right?
A lot of our fucking, our someone who works for us did not know who Frank Sinatra was. That's we can't expect our listeners, many of whom That's were born in 1995 or later, to have an understanding of who the Rolling Stones are.
All right. Let me guess, Keith Richards was at the opening of Musso and Frank's. Keith Richards, I'm going to go steak.
Okay, going with steak again.
French onion soup.
Liver and onions.
Oh, perfect.
That makes sense.
Yeah, it's like, oh yeah, these guys are 80 years old. Yeah. Like, that's an old man meal. All right, well, so last night we went, and...
Do you think Keith Richards could beat me in running a mile?
Yes. He's performing live music still all the time.
Isn't that wild?
I know. I think he'd beat me in a foot race.
Yeah.
Keith Richards could, like, kill me, and hand-to-hand, he probably could beat me.
I don't know about that. I don't think he's a fighter.
You're also a big guy.
Yeah, I could smother him here. So. Yeah. Good point. Okay.
We went on a Wednesday night. Luis was our server. He was a dream. It's like that showmanship.
Yes.
That element too, which it starts from when you walk in the door. Yes. And like there's a doorman and you're greeted and like, you know, they remember your name, which we witnessed firsthand with you.
Mm-hmm.
All that stuff is great.
Remember your name?
Yes. You messed that part.
Oh, on the way out. It was because the way out the
I was gonna say, you've never been there before.
The maitre d' had clocked that it was Evan's first time and said, like, Evan's great to see you here. I hope we see you again.
Wow.
Oh, really good. Like 2.5 hours later.
Yeah, it was great.
Well, here's the deal. I came in the back door, like the boys from Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Mm, right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've been there once or twice. But when you go in the front door there, it's great service.
I think it's worth experiencing just for that, just for kind of the magic. Because also, I think another aspect of this, and I said this last night, we should say that it is in the worst part of the city. And I don't mean in terms of like, oh, it's like the most dangerous part or anything, the seediest part.
It's hell.
It's just the grossest part of the city.
Here,
it's disgusting.
What I parked the 2 minutes of me arriving and getting seated at the table were the most insane experience of my life, which
the restaurant's on Hollywood Boulevard, which is where the Walk of Fame is. So they're like Harrison Ford star and William Peterson from CSI are outside this restaurant.
I pulled into the parking structure. That was close by.
Yeah.
And first of all, they're like, it's $20, which is insane. But I was like, I don't know where I'm parking in on Hollywood Boulevard. So I said, fine. The guy yells at me. He's like, park in a handicapped spot. I was like, okay. So I do.
He ordered you to do that.
I get out.
You should have done the valet. The valet is cheaper.
I probably should have, but I didn't want to be driving around too much. I get out. I see a person who is taking a piss right as soon as I walk out.
Yeah.
Then I walked past a souvenir shop, and then a guy who, I don't know what his deal was, but he just ran up to me and said, I'm trying to buy a cigarette for $1. And I said, I don't know. I don't have that. It was like scary. It was like the city is scary. I walk in. Then I go into this restaurant, which is all of a sudden like, yeah, going back in time. And it's like very classy. I meet the host who says, like, hello, who are you? Evan. Oh, it's so nice to meet you. I asked where the restroom is. I go into the restroom. And
there's a guy in there taking a piss.
Well, he is taking a piss, but he's also having a work conference call on speakerphone in the bathroom.
That's insane. Truly insane.
And it was just so many crazy things within
I could have seen your cowardly lion fucking ass running around Hollywood Boulevard getting scared.
I was so scared.
Cigarette. Oh, piss.
I mean,
it's not the most pleasant environment.
Hell. It's Hollywood Boulevard is bad.
Yeah, I took the bus over there, and I had the little walk up from Sunset to Hollywood, and it's grimy but aside from that, it's also just like all these tourist traps, it's all these like, you know, just the shittiest like dumbest, like grossest bars, and then just like a bunch of shops that are selling like the cheapest, like crappiest, like celebrity merchandise, you know? And then there's like the Ripley's Believe It or Not Museum and the Wax Museum. All these tourist traps are nearby. It's not a great, it's like Times Square, but it's like, you know, 1990s Times Square before everything became super gentrified. And so it just still has that layer of grime all over it.
Yes.
But once you go inside, like you said,
it's Xanadu. It's a real oasis. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's great.
I'm sorry if you were scared when you were parking.
I was scared.
So we sat down. We and this is a place where, you know, if you are someone who drinks, I think this is like, they have old school cocktails. You got the whiskey sours. I got myself a Hendrix gin martini with olives.
Yeah.
And it's fun to just, they have some signature cocktails, but I think that's the way to go there. Like, get something that's like, that someone would have gotten to the bar in 1919.
Yeah. It definitely, you know, it feels like you're just in the past and like, yeah, that's great.
It's a hopping night last night, too.
It was
packed on a Wednesday night, a random Wednesday night.
Right. We had a little trouble getting reservations.
Yes.
Originally, we were supposed to go on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. And you said, okay, well, we can do 5 p.m. on Tuesday. And...
Yeah.
Which you were thrilled about, I believe.
I would have loved to have done 5 p.m. We seated at the ungodly hour of 7:45. I was like, Jesus Christ. I was so tired.
It was packed in there when we got it. Yeah. Well, here's the deal. Wednesday night, maybe you'll see Wednesday Adams on a Wednesday night. You never know who you're going to see. Yeah, you don't know who you're going to see.
Uh-huh.
There are a lot of like just looking at people for a bit and being like, do I recognize them? And then realizing you don't and you're just staring like at an old guy.
It's Kowalik and he's in the Noid suit. there is a lot of old guys that you just kind of confuse. Going in there weekly, Danny Trejo, that is wild to me. Because do you remember
Any other people that have days of the week in their name? I was trying to do another one, but I couldn't think of someone.
Saturday, maybe.
Jeff Saturday?
Jeff Saturday is a football player.
Oh, yeah.
Gotta be more.
Frank Friday, is that a person or no?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure Frank Friday is a guy.
Well, there's his girl Friday, right?
Yeah. Oh, that would have been good.
Yeah.
All right. Anyway, go on.
Hold on.
Monday? We were kind of thinking about this. We can start with Monday and work our way forward.
Tuesday. There's going to be someone named Tuesday, right?
Probably someone named Tuesday.
Tuesday Adams?
Oh,
I know there's Wednesday Adams.
There's Wednesday Adams. That's probably what you're thinking of. Thursday.
Early modern Monday? No, it's Millie.
Right. Yeah. No, it's Millie.
So, Sus, you got scared.
Manic Monday. That's a song.
Yeah, Manic Monday. That works.
Friday, yeah. I'm in love. So, if we get opened up to songs.
Yeah. The Cure, I guess, The Cure. It was a Monday. We saw The Cure. I don't know. It's kind of
Robert Smith was there on a date.
Yeah.
He was like, Friday, I'm in love.
That's good.
Yeah.
But I mean, that didn't happen, but that would have been good. Yeah. There was no one we saw in there. Last time I was in there, I saw the knife in there. I saw the knife when I was in there with the Quincy guys.
Wow. You mean Atlanta Johnston?
Yeah.
Wow, that's awesome.
I didn't mean a fucking knife that they gave me on the fucking table.
You probably did see one, though.
I did see a knife. They gave me a knife to eat.
Yeah.
I went in there with the Quincy boys. I took my mom and my dad and my girlfriend at the like my first LA girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
I think you probably remember who it was.
Yeah.
And the four of us, so it was like one of those awkward, I think it was the first dinner I ever had with my parents with a girlfriend ever. This is 2007, maybe 2007.
Mm-hmm.
And I was not blown away the first time I had it. I was, and I got to say this too, Musso and Frank's kind of wise. I think you'll probably remember this. Remember there was like a time like in the early 2000s where it was kind of in a slump, right? Like there was like a little bit of like a...
Well, so yeah, they have swapped in different chefs over the years I was reading.
Yes,
so I think the menu's been a little bit revitalized because this is the issue with a place that's been like, you know, they have jellied consomme on the menu, which is like, is a savory, like, you know, beef jello, basically. Like, they have stuff that's like you would have eaten way, like, in the, you know, post-World War I era that doesn't really translate to today's palate. So I think they've had some new chefs come in there and shake up the menu and modernize elements of it and keep other things as they were. So, yeah, I think the food is on a little bit of an upswing based on my handful of experiences going here over the years.
Yeah, no, for sure. I think there was a little bit of a dead zone for a while there, but
right.
I've loved this place. I wasn't thrilled with the food or whatever, but my mom and dad and the lady I dated, we all four of us, we had a great time.
The vibe is great.
The vibe is great. I've been here a few times. By the way, you don't need to have your headphones on anymore.
Oh, that's right. Thank you.
Were you listening to anything? I also liked that when...
Blank check.
I like when you were like take the headphones off because it's a surprise, and then it was like a Muzak version of I did it my way. I never would have understood what the fuck was happening. Yeah, the vibe is great.
Don't yell at me. That was Emma who said that.
Oh, well, whatever.
Yeah, yell at me. Do it.
Sorry. No. I'd rather not yell at Emma.
I actually hadn't even heard it yet. I didn't know if it was spoiler.
The vibes in there are great. You could see, somebody, I told you guys that I saw Marvin Schwartz when we were in there.
That's right.
Yeah. Which was confusing.
Yeah, but it was pretty good.
That's the name of Al Pacino's character Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. But then if you Google that, there is a real producer named Marvin Schwartz who died. And then it was like, what? And then it was like, oh, that's also the name of the character.
I thought it was still pretty good that I saw Marvin Schwartz. I thought you guys would, I thought it would.
No, it was good. Once we figured it out and once we figured it wasn't like you seeing a ghost.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if you were afraid of me seeing ghosts.
I mean.
And then I said, what a podcast, which I thought was good.
That was good. Once we had the context for what you were saying, that was good.
You don't think What a Podcast is good?
It's very good.
I have my connection to this place is like very like Hollywood-y. I've been, I think my first time here was like years ago, and my then reps at the time, my agents took me out to dinner at Musso and Frank. It's kind of I think I'd just gotten a big job, and there was like a congratulations sort of thing. So we had like a nice meal there. But
congrats,
it was one of those
things. Congrats on getting the Road to Respect video game.
But it was one of those things where it was, we ate this meal and they paid for it and it was lovely. And then afterwards, I had valeted my like fucking shitty Toyota Yaris, and all three of them got like their BMW, their Audi, and their Tesla. And I was just like, I get how this town works. It was like one of those moments. And then the other thing was. I took a writing staff here from
actually,
the show I worked on.
Tesla wouldn't have been, it wouldn't have been a Tesla at that point.
He said BMW, though.
I did say Tesla as a third pull. But whatever fucking fancy car it would have been in, 2009 or whatever. Anyway, the other, I also took a writing staff there in a show I worked on as just, a kickoff dinner, and that was fun. And then also.
You took them?
Yeah. And then also.
Is this party over here?
That's right, yeah. Fox show I worked on.
Very generous.
And then I also, the last time I think I was there was pre-quarantine. I was working on Sarah Silverman's Hulu show, and it was when she got her star on the Walk of Fame. She invited everyone to go there, and so we witnessed her. Like John C. Reilly spoke, Jimmy Kimmel spoke. She said a few words.
Musso's?
This was out, they put it, her star was nearby.
Wow.
And then afterwards,
did they rent out the whole restaurant?
Afterwards, yes. We went into the restaurant and we had the restaurant. But here's the thing. It was really cool to be in there, but it was also the middle of the day, so it was a little bit different energy. And also the food was just catered.
Yeah.
It wasn't you could order off the full menu. But it was still this place has some Hollywood iconography, and that's my connection to it. And those are my memories of it.
I had can I tell a little Hollywood? I mean, why not?
Mm-hmm.
This isn't bragging. The thing never happened.
Yeah.
But I met with me and Bugmane and Armin and Jack wrote a pilot, and we met with Tom Gamble and Max Pross, who I worked for at The Simpsons. And we talked to them about maybe running this pilot that we wrote, the show, and we had lunch at Musso. It was a big, nice Hollywood lunch at Musso and Frank's.
Yeah.
None of it happened. It didn't work out, but it was fun in the moment.
Yeah, that's the thing. It's all none of it works out, but it's fun.
Yeah. Yeah, in fact, none of these things... Starting with that, the woman who I used to date, that didn't work out.
Yeah, none of this stuff works out.
The show you worked on?
Nothing I worked on worked out.
Nothing, it didn't work out. So interesting.
Yeah.
So now we bring the podcast.
We got the, I will say, I like my martini. I think they make good stiff, classic cocktails there. I also, just in terms of the showmanship, I like that it's a place where the servers just, remember your order and also, get it right.
Yeah.
That's part of the fun.
There was more showmanship before. Things did change a little bit because they did used to make a salad there. I'm sure of it.
A table side salad.
Yeah, they used to make
a
table
side salad.
Are you
thinking of Lowry's?
No, I know that they do it at Lowry's too, but I swear they used to do one at Musso's. Maybe I'm just wrong.
I don't remember this, but I trust you. Susser and I got the Caesar salads, and you got the dinner salad.
Which I like that dinner salad quite
good
a lot.
Good plate-sized salad, too. It's an appetizer salad. It's meant for one. It's not an entree, but it is this is a substantial amount of greens.
Well, before you even get into that salad,
yeah.
they bring in that nice sourdough bread with a delicious butter.
Bread is a lot of fun.
It's great.
The butter was very good.
The butter is
great.
I did
note the butter.
Yeah.
And I thought that bread used to be warm, but maybe never it was either. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'm just, things changed with the pandemic and stuff. I have no idea. But I loved my dinner salad. It has some beets on there, Wags.
That's right.
It's a, you got that house dressing, which is kind of like Thousand Islandese. It was, I loved it. How was the Caesar?
Quality Caesar.
It was a good Caesar.
Solid. Mm-hmm. Very solid. And we also got a shrimp cocktail. Now, five shrimps. That's the thing. That's awkward to share for pretty much any sized party.
And here's the funny thing about that breakdown. Mm-hmm. I ate three of the shrimp.
Well, here's the thing. Mitch introduced it. Like, so what should we get? And Mitch goes, well, I had the shrimp cocktail last time I was here, and it was not that good. Let's get the shrimp cocktail. And I was like, okay. I didn't really have something that I wanted more than that. I can like a shrimp cocktail. And then
I wanted to give the shrimp cocktail a second shot.
And it arrived, and I had it. I didn't think it was terrible, but I didn't think it was that good.
It's fine. It's and a especially fine shrimp cocktail.
It's fine, yeah. The it problem, used to be better.
The problem is, though, if someone introduces it and says, it's not very good, and you have that kind of in your mind, and you're like, it is not that good.
Yeah.
Also, I think at a place like that, I was kind of expecting or thinking in my mind like the big jumbo shrimp cocktail.
Well, yeah. Sure, so that was my point of comparison. Is like if you go to Hillstone and you get a shrimp cocktail, you get those big boys, those jumbo shrimp.
There's something happening with the shrimp there because they used to also bring it on ice, I thought, and now it comes like on vegetable and a little cup and vegetables and like shredded lettuce or whatever. But the shrimp cocktail,
I should probably order it 10 more times.
I mean, look. There's something that I didn't order and I regretted not ordering it. I got scared out of ordering
it. We'll talk about it.
We'll get into it.
Speaking of ice, thing I really like, this is another thing they do at Hillstone. They give you a little sidecar for the rest of your cocktail
that's very cool. That's very cool.
And you know what? When your drink starts to get a little low and maybe you haven't even clocked it yet, your waiter comes over and he refills it from the sidecar himself.
A little craft.
The service there is fantastic.
Great service. Great. We also
look, it is like, it's that sort of thing of like, if for listeners who get mad at us for going to a fancy steakhouse, which I don't know if anyone will or not, it's expensive, but it also is like we were wearing baseball caps. Maybe we're just assholes.
No, yeah, you're kind of assholes.
Well, there's a little.
Well, you were dressed up like a dork.
I thought it would be fun to dress up, and then I thought it was funny that you guys went the other way.
Yeah, we did.
I was doing shit all day. Yeah, like I came from.
Yeah, me too.
And then you came in. You're like, I'll take off my hat. And then you like, I gotta put this fucking hat back on.
I kept mine on. And then when you see the guys like in the red suits looking at you, you're like, they probably hate our fucking guts.
No, but this is the thing, because you will see people wearing full suits. You will see like high powered like exec types and agent types, you know, who are dressed to the nines. But then you'll also see just like tourists wearing like a Tommy Bahama shirt and
get them out of there.
It's like, I don't know. I like that though. I like that there's that element.
Well, it is also kind of the Hollywood.
Very
thing
Hollywood,
of,
yeah.
I say it's expensive, but also you could probably not break the bank if you wanted to if you went in there and ordered correctly. It's a little expensive. I'm just saying. I'm just saying it's not the most. It's not the fanciest, most expensive place around. It's not.
No, you're no. This is like, look, if you went to like a Ruth's Chris Steakhouse or a Morton Steakhouse, you could easily spend as much as you spend at Musso and Frank and not have the as good of an experience.
Yeah,
for sure. Okay, so let's talk steaks a little bit because this is the order of the day.
Yeah.
So, I mean, do you want to talk about what your move?
I wanted the ribeye cap, and I went in there thinking, I'm going to get the ribeye cap. I wanted this ribeye cap. I've had it before. My mom, sister, and I, when Tomorrow War came out, we went to Musso and Frank's, and I got the ribeye cap, and I loved it.
Can you explain what a ribeye cap is? Because I actually hadn't heard of it until
we
were there.
It's just like the tender top of the ribeye, basically. And I went in there, and they don't always have it. And I asked him, I said, do you got the ribeye cap? And he said, we got one. He said, it's 8 ounces, though.
Yeah.
And that scared me because
it's also like 8 ounces. I have a hard time when I see like I'm like, how much meat do I need? Like I was like, is 8 ounces small?
8 ounces is pretty small.
It's half the size of the normal ribeye or the bone in ribeye, which is 16 ounces.
Yeah.
So you were getting you're getting a smaller portion of a more succulent meat.
So that scared me off.
Yeah.
8 ounces is like, you know, it's like a tenth of a baby, right?
It depends on the baby, but yeah.
I mean, look, I shouldn't put it into baby terms. I'm just saying it's like we're talking baby weight at this point. 8 ounces?
16 ounces is a pound.
Yeah.
Yeah. Half a pound.
So small.
Do you think a baby is what size?
The math there, you said an eighth of it. That would be a 4-pound baby.
It doesn't matter how much a baby fucking weighs.
Yeah.
Well, you brought it up, babies. It's not like we brought up babies.
A baby's diaper could weigh 5 ounces, for Christ's sakes.
Sure. Mm.
So, I mean, that's also not gross image. Not to think
fucking
fun to
disgusting.
Think about.
Baby shit-filled diaper being the same size as the
How
food
much
we
do
ate.
Your diapers weigh?
Yeah, great question.
I don't wear diapers. 8 ounces just. 8 ounces seemed small.
Yes.
8 ounces seemed small.
Yeah.
I had it. What's that?
You wish. Not.
You're making some sort of dick
yeah,
joke or something?
I don't really yeah. have it all together.
My dick doesn't weigh 8 ounces, know, that's for sure. You think my dick weighs 0.5 pound? I would love for an 8-ounce dick.
I wonder if that would be an appealing thing. Like, oh, bet she's got such a heavy dick.
She's got a great idea for the next episode of The Scale.
Dear God.
Okay, anyway, what were you talking about, babies?
Okay, so he said his 8 ounces. He scared me off.
Yeah.
The waiter, who I liked a lot.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
You scared me off, and
well,
because
like, you were like, okay, you thought you could get two of them to make.
Well, that's what I thought. That's what I. Hold on a second. That's what I thought he was saying.
Yes, uh-huh.
I thought he was like, it's 8 ounces, and I thought he was saying like you get two. Like I thought he was saying it was like a smaller cut tonight,
right?
So you can order two. But he was just telling.
I mean,
me,
I think you could have. I don't think he would have arrested you.
Or
I
probably it was the last one.
Yeah.
But also, you like it's like the same price as the regular ribeye because it's a higher quality. So mm-hmm. like it's you would have been spending a pretty penny there.
So I've had it before. I knew the size. I knew it was smaller.
Yeah.
But I was just like, ugh, it scared me off. You had right before me ordered the ribeye.
That's right.
I say, never mind. I'll get the ribeye too. Then this guy switches his order.
That's right. I said, if he's not going to have the ribeye cap, which I was saving for you, I said, I'll take it myself.
And in my mind, when he got off it, I had never even heard of the ribeye cap. I'm like, oh, maybe I'll switch. But you jumped in and switched. And I didn't know if it was the last one, or I also didn't want to steal your move of being like, I'll actually take it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So then I got the bone in ribeye.
Mm-hmm. Ribeye cap also kind of funny. Sounds like a hat. You know?
Yeah. Or like Captain America.
Yeah. There's a lot of fun stuff.
There's a lot of fun stuff. But anyway, the steaks come. And I have mine, and Nick very generously offered to give us all a bite.
Yeah.
And I'm so mad that you did, because I had the bite, and I said, it's so much better. I ordered wrong.
It was really
and instead
good.
Of it's enjoying so good. This also good steak, now I had, you know, comparison is the thief of joy.
That's true.
And now
what
I just
that
had...
Line?
Comparison is the thief of joy, which is maybe not what the expression is, but I think I've heard something like that.
Something like that, yeah.
Anyway, so now I just had this better.
Comparison is the death of happiness. They're all there's versions of this. The
Don't
idea is that
compare to anything.
Once you start comparing yourself or anything that you have into mm-hmm. what other people are, you stop enjoying it.
You start comparing this podcast to blank check. You stop enjoying it.
What are we doing here?
And so then I just had that, and I'm like, I fucked up with the order. And it's such a, and I was telling you guys, you know, my wife's a vegetarian, so I don't get out to a lot of steakhouses.
Right.
Mm-hmm. This is the only steakhouse I've been to in the past, I don't even remember, before pandemic. Like four years. I guess if you count Tam O'Shanter's, I guess that's not true. That's a, kind of a slightly separate thing, though.
Sure, sure.
Its own vibe.
Are we supposed to be feeling sad for you right now?
Well, I just was saying that I just was in my head. I was like, I fucked up the order, and it made me sad.
Yeah.
To have messed up the order.
Mine was delightful.
Yes, the ribeye cap was fantastic. I didn't get to try a bite of the bone-in ribeye. You ate it all and didn't really offer.
I think that it wasn't that different. You thought...
It would have been nice to try. You know, Wags, when you feel the same way.
Did you give him a piece of yours?
No, but
I gave Wager a piece.
Yeah, because he gave me a piece of his, and you gave me a piece of yours.
Yeah.
So, like, we all did swaps, but mm-hmm. it's just this was a two of you issue.
Yeah. He was on his end of the table.
You guys were sitting next to each other.
How? What did you think of the steak breakdown when you try the different bites?
I would put yours,
the only one who tried every bite of every steak.
I would have given yours the bronze. I hate to tell you, I think the bone in was better than the boneless. Wow. But I mean, that's also just my personal tendency. I prefer the bone in. Mm. I think
I liked my steak quite a bit. I mean, the
yours
steaks,
was good. They were all good.
The last time
the
I was
steaks
there,
are good. That's
the
thing
reason,
you get there.
And I'll because I went not that long ago, and the reason I went for the ribeye is because the last time I was there, I had like my favorite ribeye I've ever had. So like
right.
You can get lucky there. I think that the food quality can be It can go up and down. I think sometimes you'll get better stuff and other times it won't be as good. But the shrimp cocktail is an example of that. But for the most part, you're getting a lot of good food.
I was curious, Weiger. I know you've been eating a lot less red meat. I wasn't even sure what you were going to do when we were eating. I didn't know if you were even going to eat red meat. When was the last time you had had a steak or red meat?
Well, here's the thing. We fairly recently did Black Angus.
Oh,
so when we did
right.
Black
you
Angus,
fucking
I get
fraud.
The steak there.
Okay.
Stole my cap. You stole the cap.
You passed
you
it up.
You ordered it. You
I
chose
know,
not
I know.
To get
you
it.
Stole it from me. Damn it. I wanted that cap. I'm going to have to go back for a cap.
You can do it.
Steak cap. It sounds like a nightcap. You uh-huh. know what I'm saying?
Oh, that's fun.
Yeah. Three more shrimp cocktails.
Okay, so
the steaks were all good. We didn't talk sides.
Let's talk sides a little bit. First off, we got a peppercorn sauce and their steak sauce.
Okay, this is, when you talk about not expensive, the amount they charge you for just sauce is insane.
Yeah, it's
$9
for a sauce. That,
yeah, it's absurd. This is the thing. That's where you see the markup. It's things like the sauce or like the asparagus that we got, which was, you know, $16 for, crazy. I think we each got 4 spears.
Yeah.
So, look, this is one of those places where the steaks come a la carte and all of the sides are for Sharon.
That's on you guys. I'd go no greens all day, every day. you guys said a green vegetable would be good. You brought up asparagus. I had the broccolini last time I was there, and it was kind of doused in oil. And then the asparagus I thought was, well, could have been seasoned a little bit more, but the béarnaise sauce did a lot of the...
it's a hollandaise sauce, but yeah, it's a similar sort of sauce. Oops. And I think it's just completely unseasoned. But I think it was actually Susser's call to get the asparagus.
Yeah, well, I just was going for a green. I went for asparagus. Yeah.
I think it was the right move. We got potatoes two ways, which I was like, I don't think we need that many potatoes. And I was wrong. Because, Mitch, we got the mashed potatoes, which were good. Mm-hmm. But then we also got the Lyonnaise potatoes.
Yeah.
The
which
Lyonnaise
were
potatoes were great, and we probably would have not gotten them. If we
would not have gotten them if we'd only opted for one potato.
Yeah.
So that was the right move.
I thought it was insulting to my heritage and my culture for you to say we could only get one potato. And I thought the two potato move was turned out to be great. The Lyonnaise potato, that's how you say it. I don't know how you pronounce it. But I might get that every time I go there.
That's what I was going to say. Fantastic. I think that's what I would nudge anyone towards if they're trying to figure out which of the, you know, half dozen potato preparations to get. Try out those Lyonnaise.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's flash boiled, or it's just like it's parboiled and then they flash fry it. I think that's the process.
It's interesting. There's a little bit of a tangent that you would nudge someone when ordering. Do you feel that obligation when you go to dinner with someone or lunch with someone to be like,
as a doughboy?
No, just in general, as a person to be like,
yes,
you don't want them to order badly.
Yeah, if I know the place and they don't, for sure, I'll give them a little bit of guidance.
Yeah.
Because this is also a thing. You're looking at this big, like, this. It's the fucking long menus, and there's a lot of options.
There's people who, look, there's like, you know, I think that I will be opinionated about it. There's guys like Armin, our good friend Armin, who will take control of ordering. You know what I mean? There's like
I don't go that far. I'm not gonna unless someone wants me to take the reins, I'm gonna do that.
Yeah.
I like to do a bit when I'm eating lunch with someone, I like, oh, what are you gonna get? And find out ahead of time. And then when the waiter comes, I like do it like a dad and be like, and this guy right here is gonna get the club sandwich.
That's fun.
It's fun.
No one this is like it. With your I don't like that. That sucks.
I guess we should talk desserts real quick.
I was going to say the peppercorn sauce is my favorite of the sauce.
Quality sauce.
Yeah.
The hollandaise, which I thought was a béarnaise, the hollandaise sauce, which I thought we'd try to order one of each sauce because there was a béarnaise sauce, right? I guess we didn't get it.
We got
ketchup,
the two sauces.
A steak sauce, and the peppercorn sauce. I thought the peppercorn sauce was close. It's kind of like a gravy.
Yeah, it's fun. We also got for dessert, we got the 1919 sundae. Which I believe it's vanilla ice cream, peanut brittle, and butterscotch. Kind of an unconventional combination, and also I feel like a lot of times you were saying this, Mitch. Usually Sundays are so chocolate dominated a restaurant that it was nice to see a non chocolate sundae.
That was a
Susser observation.
But I will say this:
do we want to take it back?
So we also got the 1919 sundae, and this is a sundae that's vanilla ice cream, peanut brittle, and butterscotch. Mm-hmm. And Susser was saying, normally you see a sundae and it's so dominated by chocolate.
That's right, Nick. That was something that I said last night. You know, I think that, look, there's nothing wrong with chocolate sauce on a sundae.
No.
But I think it's nice to kind of see something different and be like, hey, this is how they did it in 1919.
Right.
So that's a great thing it has.
Yeah.
Okay.
Me, I was like so surprised you knew so much about sauces. When I look at you, I'm like, this guy doesn't know anything about sauces. You know everything about sauces. You like sauce. You like chocolate. You like sauce. You're a sauce man.
He's sauced in Powers. He's sauced in Powers. He's sauced in Powers. He's sauced in Powers.
You spill sauce on my couch.
It's true.
I spilled ranch. Is ranch a sauce?
Yeah, it's a sauce.
It's a sauce.
It's both a dressing and a sauce.
We might
and
be
a dip.
Exploring that topic more in the future.
Yeah.
Wow.
No, I don't know. I don't think we will, honestly.
Sunday was great.
I had the Sunday the last time I was there. So I was like, I don't need to have the Sunday again, but because I'm such a mensch.
What the fuck? You were like, oh, we don't need to get the Sunday again. It was great. And even though it
Hold
was
on
great,
a second.
But then the shrimp, you were like, they're bad. We have to get it again.
I'm sorry.
The good item, you said, I had it. It was great. We don't need to get it again. The bad item.
No, let's be clear here. Sus saw a thing that he wanted from the beginning.
Yeah.
Which was what were they? It was the flannel cakes? The flannel cakes.
Which we ended up getting with flannel cakes.
Which they looked a lot like pancakes. I was like, are those pancakes?
Yeah.
And then the fact that they were maybe pancakes seemed like you wanted them more.
It was interesting to me. I think it's interesting when you go to a restaurant and they have something on the menu that seems like they should not have on the menu.
It's also not part of the dessert menu. It's listed with the appetizers, but it clearly seems to be some sort of sweet treat. And it was. It came with, our version came with
berries.
Well,
no, it's actually both on the regular menu and then on the dessert menu. I'm like, they are trying to sell, maybe they have too many of them.
Probably.
But they're really pushing them.
It was like a crepe and it had ours had berries and yogurt.
And they said they used to serve them at lunch, and Sus really wanted these crepes, the flannel cakes or whatever. And I thought that those were going to be hot, and I just wanted one hot dessert, and that's I said,
you
okay.
You think you would be excited about them?
I
love flannel.
That's
love
true.
Cakes.
Touché. You're right. I do. I wasn't sure about them. I thought they were a pancake, and then they said they're crepes. I said, hey, let's try them. They were cold. They were served cold. Yeah. Which was the only downside. I had had that Sunday before, but I'm such a mensch. Can you say that about yourself? I was such a mensch.
No.
I was such a mensch. I said, this is Sunday is so good. We got to have it again. And let me tell you, it was so good once again. That Sunday
delightful
is like
Sunday.
One of the best Sundays. They got that caramelized banana in there.
Oh, yeah. I forgot to mention the banana.
Oh, my God. Another element. So fucking good. And like you were saying, Wags, I believe you were saying this, just so unlike any Sunday that you usually have.
Yeah, not a conventional steakhouse.
I think you were saying like usually you get like chocolate in your Sunday.
Right, yeah.
Can we take it back?
Sure. So I think, Wags, I think you were saying.
all right, we should take our second break. We should come right back and give our fork score.
Okay.
Well, what?
I don't know. I felt like there was more.
We didn't talk about our whiskey sours, and then I also got myself a
that's right.
Daiquiri?
A daiquiri? What the fuck?
The year's almost over. Just
all
fucking
right,
end
go
it.
To break. We'll be back with our fork score review.
I thought that there was like a sophisticated way to say daiquiri.
I think it's
my
just
head.
Daiquiri.
Nope, I think you just said a slur instead.
We'll take another break. We'll be right back with more Doughboys.
Relaxing dumps are great, but dealing with the aftermath, not so much. Wiping only spreads poop or shit around. Give yourself the ultimate clean and turn your bathroom into a personal oasis with a refreshing stream of clean water from a Hello Tushy bidet. Me, I love using that bidet. Love that tushy. And hey, you feel clean and refreshed. It completely changes up your daily routine of going to the restroom. I mean, wiping used to be nasty. But now, still nasty, but less so. Hello Tushy attaches to your existing toilet, transforming it into a personal sanctuary. The patented self-cleaning smart spray and build-up resistant design helps to minimize grime buildup, and it even has antimicrobial knobs, making your weekly cleaning chore a whole lot easier. Make your post-dump experience even better with their precision nozzle adjuster, offering a targeted stream that provides an effective yet gentle clean that is 2 times better than wiping alone. Every Hello Tushy bidet comes with a 30-day hassle-free return and a 12-month warranty. Join the over 1 million real pooping humans who have made the switch. Hello Tushy is offering our listeners an exclusive limited-time offer of 15% off your first bidet order plus free shipping. Go to hellotushy.com/doughboys for 15% off all bidets. That's hellotushy.com and you enter promo code Doughboys at checkout. See site for details.
All right, welcome back to Doughboys. It's time for our fork scores for Musso and Frank. So, Suster, you've been on the podcast before. Your first visit, your maiden voyage to Musso and Frank, this Hollywood institution. Your thoughts, your fork score.
Man, it's tough. I feel like because this is such a fancy meal, an expensive meal, it was such a treat.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys took me, and it was very, very nice. I appreciate it. I feel like I'm an asshole if I don't say five forks. And there's a lot that's great about it. The atmosphere cannot be beat. It's a home run. The food is very good.
Yeah.
I think you do have to weigh the price point because it's expensive. But it also is, it's not just a meal. It's also like a life experience.
Sure.
It's like going to, you know, like a, it's like stepping into the past.
Mm-hmm.
It's stepping, you know, it's kind of like going to a museum. And you should feel just as good about going to this restaurant than going to a museum.
Mm. It's more fun than a museum.
I don't think...
Museum food sucks.
It's true. Now that there have been a few six forkers in Doughboys,
mm-hmm.
I don't think it makes it to six forks.
Mm.
But you know what? I feel pretty good at putting it at five forks.
Five forks. Very good score. Mitch, what do you think?
Look, the first time I went here, it was with my dad and my mom back in the early days of Hollywood when I first moved out here. And like I said, I wasn't blown away by the food that first time. You know, I've gone many times over. I've had one of the best steaks I've ever had in my life there. There's been great moments. It's the experience is bigger than the food, but I think the food is also really fantastic now. The cocktails are great.
Yes.
Sus, how many sixes have I given out so far?
Just two, I believe.
Was it two or three?
I think it's three.
Banchan, did you give out a third one?
Guisados, banchan.
Guisados. Banchan, guisados, and Zanku you gave six forks to.
Oh, yeah.
I've only given out one.
I've given out three, which is also, I don't like that I've given three sixes out. I gotta say, I'm giving a fourth six today, Wags. A six forker.
Now, you've done no five and a half.
No.
Okay.
What a restaurant. That's what I say, Wags. It's one of the best fun. There is. I mean, come on. I think it's one of the best restaurants in the world. For what the experience and for what it is, it's fucking, it rules. It's Hollywood, and I love my city. I love Hollywood, California. Hollywood's come on. Like I said, there's been a lot of tough stuff this year. Look, for real, the world is a mess. It's a bad. Mm-hmm. It's a bad and some bad stuff. I wasn't trying to cry about myself. I had a health scare, but I'm doing okay compared to. Then the world is going through horrible stuff. It makes me sad. Most of all, Hollywood has come under attack in the last few years.
It's true.
And you know, I love Hollywood. I love the good history of Hollywood, and that place is that good, great, warm feeling of the history of Hollywood when you're in there. And
yeah,
the food is great. It transports you to another time. That salad's fantastic. The shrimp cocktail used to be good. It slipped a little bit, but still, whatever. You can have one of the best steaks. You get that ribeye cap. I mean, come on. The service is top of the line, Wags. The drinks, and now the memories for me, including last night.
That was a lovely
meal. It's a six forker, my fourth six forker. I won't give out many, but that's...
I mean, you've given out three this year. So I think
I will say that's an uptick. That's an uptick in six forks.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
That's a lot.
But this one deserves six forks.
Okay. I think your fork score is your fork score. I think it's possible you're diminishing the significance of the six fork by giving it out a little
Jesus
too loose. A little too casual.
You're going to have to move up to seven.
how to wrap up my thoughts on this restaurant on Musso and Frank, this Hollywood institution.
Who is Musso? Did we talk about that?
They're just the guys who founded the restaurant.
Is it last name?
Pretty sure it's a last name.
Okay.
And Frank is a last name?
I mean, I should have this context. I had this earlier. I don't have it in front of me. I believe it was...
Musso's a pretty funny name. If his name is like Musso, he sounds like a bully. He sounds like my kind of guy is what I'm trying to say.
I don't know. Yeah, let's see if I can find the about page here. People can look this up.
I feel like I would audition for a role named Musso, which I can do now. Now that the strike is over.
Okay, here's the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Frank is a first name. Musso is a last name.
I love it.
Frank Toulé and Joseph Musso.
Yeah, that wasn't even really that hard to figure out. I don't know why it was a mystery.
What a weird combination. Two people, one of them using their first name, one of them using their last.
Wild.
Nick and Mitch.
I think this place is great. I think it's fun that it's in Bosch. I think that it's, you know.
That's what you think it's fun in?
It's fun
that it's
in
Bosch. It's fun that it's
in Bosch. Bosch
it's fun that it's in
time.
Once Upon a Time in Hollywood,
that's
one of the best
fun.
Movies of all.
That's also fun. But I'm just saying, like it just, it's also fun that it exists in things like that. That it exists in, like, you know, more just like, hey, this is this procedural that's on Prime that dads love. And they get this dude's hanging out at Bosch all the time. Bosch is hanging out, rather, at Musso and Frank all the time.
Why are you talking about Bosch so much? Bosch?
Well, it's not the only thing that it has that it's referenced in.
Yeah.
But also, like, it's fun that it's in Bosch. That's an independent thought. It's
okay,
also
sure.
fun
know,
that it's in Ocean's 11, but it's fun that it's in Bosch.
It's fun. It is fun that it's in Bosch.
It's
fun
Bosch.
That it's in Bosch.
I think Bosch Legacy goes there too.
Jesus Christ.
How to sum up my thoughts on Musso and Frank, this Hollywood institution, I think I will turn to
Bosch.
I wish I had a quote from the actor who plays Bosch. But I don't. What I have is
Marvin
a quote
Schwartz?
From, I wish I had that too. What I have is a quote from the director of the cutting satire, Don't Look Up, Adam McKay. Quote, "The first time I went to Musso and Frank was because we had done Anchorman at DreamWorks and I met Steven Spielberg. We had been chatting and he said, 'Have you been to Musso and Frank?' And I was like, 'No, I haven't.' And he said, 'You have to go. It's the oldest Italian restaurant in Hollywood.'" I don't think it's an Italian restaurant.
They do have pasta.
Do have an Italian menu.
It's
an
Italian steakhouse, I think. Yeah.
"But I went with my wife and I was like, 'Steven Spielberg said we have to go here again. It's fabulous. It's an amazing place, but the food wasn't very good.' And then I saw Spielberg again and I was like, 'That was a cool joint.' He was like, 'It's not about the food, man. Get a cocktail. Hang.' So the next time we went, we got it. We were like Musso and Frank's. And then we dove into the menu more and we found the good food." It is about vibes. It's about hanging out there. And it's got great vibes. It's a great place to hang out. Again, like I mentioned, it's great that it's an oasis away from, you know, one of the most noxious parts of a city that can be oftentimes, you know, very gross and seedy, mm-hmm. like that stretch of roadway in front of the restaurant. Mm-hmm. And then you go inside and you're transported to a different time. It's a lot of fun.
Oh, wait.
I think for this.
Hold on.
Yeah.
You still have that quote up. There's more. I was like, and then Steven said to me, "If you ever make a show about the Lakers, don't cast Will Ferrell as Jerry Buss."
Yeah, weird.
Spielberg's
it's
weird. Fault.
That came from.
Oh, weird.
Steve.
All right. Anyway, go on.
I don't think.
What?
I loved it.
I don't think in a vacuum this place is a Faye Forker, but it does not exist in a vacuum. It's a part of. It has its legacy. Again, it's the oldest restaurant in Hollywood. It's a part of film history. And I think if you're visiting
Bosch
the city, or you live in the city, Bosch goes there. I think it's worth experiencing for that alone. Like Mitch said, the food can be up and down. So this is a Faye Fork experience. I would recommend anyone go to Musso and Frank.
Can I interject for a second?
Yeah.
Well, you're done.
Yeah.
But when you walk into Musso and Frank's, do look up and take in the history.
Wow. Oh. And look and oh, can I interject?
Mm-hmm.
And also do look around too.
It's interesting because there is a sign you go inside and it's like you can only take photographs at your table because you know celebrities dine there and they don't want paparazzi around, and that's part of why you know a Danny Trejo is comfortable eating there every week.
I hate the paparazzi. Sorry,
oh,
you just reminded
fucking,
me.
Those are scum.
I hate the
They're
fucking
scum.
Paparazzi.
All right, we got to do a segment.
No good
let me
paparazzo.
Go get
you know what the autograph hounds? They're just selling those autographs.
You know, and this also reminded me. I should go. I should Steven and. And McKay and I should go to
Musso.
To Musso. Yeah.
All right. Amelia is back.
Amelia's back. Yes. Hi,
so
Amelia.
We have our, it's time for the shake part of Steak and Shake 8. And we've got a beverage. And we're going to decide if you should pour it down your throat. It's Drink or Stank, Shake or Ache Edition. Mitch, because the SAG after strike is over, we now have permission to cover the Shake Shack Trolls Band Together shakes.
Whoa, oh my God, thank God.
Under the old rules, we could not have covered this. We would have been in violation of the SAG after contract, but now we can
Let
cover
me
this
just
promotional
say,
shake.
Thank God Twisted
thank
Monthal
you,
got cut short.
Yeah.
And instead we get to do the troll shakes because look.
Yeah.
who cares, right, about my stuff? It's more about the trolls. We love trolls the show.
Susser, are you as a bit of a troll yourself?
No.
And also, as you're
trolling us at the start of the episode.
Yeah, I guess so.
as a two-time father, have you taken in the Trolls franchise?
Yes, I have taken in the Trolls franchise.
What do you think of the Trolls movies?
They are movies that I've probably seen like 10 times, but never all the way through.
Right, sure.
But I like them. They've got some music. They're kids' movies that are for kids.
Got it.
Which is, I think, a good. They're musical, which is good.
That's fun.
Was Thomas Hayden Church going to be on the podcast? Yes.
Did he confirm?
I talked to him on the phone. Yeah. Nev Campbell, we were going to go out with. We were going to go out to.
Yeah, okay.
Now you're making promises for people that you're like, we didn't book somebody.
We were going to try.
When Ray Liotta passed away.
Mackie?
And you said that he almost was on the podcast, and it was you thought about emailing someone once about it.
Ray Liotta, and I did email someone.
And they never responded?
Anthony Mackie almost came on.
Did he?
Yeah. MJ is still going to come on. The showrunner we're going to have
on. That's
right.
We're going to have him on for a special episode.
We're going to talk.
Let's Twisted Metal,
which I'm proud of. It's on Peacock now. Check it out.
We've got a okay. So the ones we've got.
Suss is already helping himself, by the way.
Poppy's Sugar Cookie Shake, which is hand spun sugar cookie, frozen custard mixed with cookie dough pop candy, topped with whipped cream and cotton candy. Viva's Cinnamon Roll Shake, hand spun cinnamon roll, frozen custard,
he's just
swirled
drinking.
With gold
he's not
frosting,
even...
topped with whipped cream and now is the time for him to drink while I am reading all this copy.
All right, I'm gonna do it too.
Viva's Cinnamon Roll Shake, which is hand spun with cinnamon roll, frozen
he's
custard,
just drinking now.
Swirled with gold frosting, topped with whipped cream and gold confetti, and then finally Branch's Chocolate Peppermint Shake, which is hand spun vanilla and chocolate frozen custard mixed with mint fudge, topped with whipped cream and mint candy crunch. I have one word to describe each of these shakes individually and collectively, which is ungapachka. I think these all have too much going on.
So but just in case Amelia got a plain vanilla and a plain chocolate.
Oh. Okay, as a baseline.
Yeah.
Just in case one of us drank all of one of the shakes.
Yeah,
we need
or
something
you
else
were so infuriated by the ungapachka that you needed something simple.
I do have a napkin. There
I gotta tell you, I agree. There's a cotton candy chunk on this that is like hard. Ugh. But I'm gonna say this. The shake's pretty good.
I'm going to take, I think the move here
these
is
are
I'm
from
just going to retain my own. Yeah, these are from Shake Shack.
This is the cheapest looking Shake Shack stuff I've ever seen.
What do you mean? In what sense?
It like looks like, look at like the, there's dumb troll shit on the cups. I don't know. It just seems like, I don't know.
It's entered in the Shake Shack has fully gone, they've gone basically full fast food chain now, where they're just like, we're just going to have promotional tie-ins with the big movie that's coming out with a big kids IP, and we're going to do some shake and we're going to do a dumb stupid cup for it. So yeah, that's the phase they are in their business model. All right, Mitch is handing over this one. Which one is this?
I like that. That's the sugar cookie
this
one.
This is the sugar cookie. It's cotton candy. I don't know what cotton candy has a connection to sugar cookie. To me, that seems like its own thing.
So you've tried each one so far.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts?
If I'm confused, which one? Those cinnamon. I think the cinnamon roll shake I really liked. The what's the
chocolate minty one?
The Branch's chocolate peppermint shake was not as impressed by that one.
Sugar cookie shake is not bad. It's got some decent, I think, and some decent texture through the straw here. And I kind of like the sugar cookie custard. It's a good flavor. It's not. I was worried it was going to taste kind of Play-Doh-y, but it kind of has its own character. All right, I'm going to move on to the cinnamon roll shake. What did y'all think of the cinnamon roll shake?
I thought that was, so far, it's been my favorite of the bunch.
Look, can I say something to invoke a different character from the Austin Powers franchise? When it comes to food, I don't love gold. I don't need gold flakes and gold leaf and all that shit in any food I'm going to eat. Leave that as wrappers.
I pulled a wire.
Wait, when did he ever?
I'm covered in.
Oh my God. Susser spilled.
Jesus,
so
I don't know how this happened.
How did that happen?
It was in your straw, you fool.
Yeah, because this idea of keeping your own straw. That's not. Yeah.
Thank you, Emma.
There's also now, just showing the camera that there's now chocolate on the top of the.
Oh my gosh.
I think I'm going to keep those as our personal Doughboys paper towels. So.
It's a good call.
They're just fucking covered in shit. They're fucking stained
shit,
paper towels.
Chocolate, whatever.
I thought this was, this one's kind of science-y, the cinnamon roll shake. I love it. I love the gold frosting.
Should I have waited for my really serious health concerns to talk about them while you were covered in shake instead?
Yeah.
Or should I have done it at the top where Weiger was covered in coffee? You fucking slobs.
Actually, can you hand me the paper towels, Mitch? And then hand me that, the third one, the chocolate peppermint, when you get a chance.
Don't worry about the chair sauce. I'll get it later.
All
right. Here's something funny.
Thanks, buddy.
Here's something funny. This regular chocolate shake is not, it's not that great.
Has Shake Shack fallen off in the shake department?
Wow.
This is just like, it's just very icy. You'll see.
I mean, I'm probably not going to have any.
Give me a sip. Come on. Give it a sip.
Fuck.
Just use my straw.
Well, hold on. Let me finish this one first.
Horrible virus that you have.
Look, did I have maybe a virus that made me go insane? Yes, but still, just try it.
I hate this.
Yeah.
Chocolate peppermint is disgusting.
It's icy. I'll see
that's what a that's a that's a hard remember, stank or ache.
Remember use the straw.
All right, here we go. I'm going to have a little bit of the chocolate now. Sester, how often do you have a shake?
A few times a day. I don't know how often I have a milkshake. Pretty rarely. There are something that I like a lot, but they also just there's certain foods that I just feel like, well, that's an insane thing to eat.
Exactly. It's always, and they're like expensive to get out a lot of times. And also, I feel like I'm just 100% going to have diarrhea.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, it's not worth it.
But I like them a lot, but I don't.
This is your favorite?
The sugar cookie, yeah.
Sugar cookie's my favorite.
No, the sugar cookie's my favorite. Do you like the cinnamon roll. Bun?
Oh, no, yeah, I did like the cinnamon roll.
I didn't like that
one. I agree with why.
It tastes chemical.
Yeah, it tastes chemical.
Yeah. I mean, all of these, but these are very much like for kids.
That's the thing. You know what? I'm going to give these all stanks. I'm going to give this collectively stanks because this is not for me. This is for children. If you're really into the Trolls franchise and you want to, I guess, taste the Trolls, then have them in shake form at Shake Shack. But I don't need to have this again. I'd much rather have this regular chocolate one.
Which one is my star? Oh, whatever.
I'm done with shakes. I'm not going to have any more shakes.
I disagree. I think that the sugar cookie one is a drink.
That's the only one I like. So I guess if I was going to break them off individually, I would say that one was is a drink or is a shake.
Or is an ache.
And the other two are aches.
Did you try the chocolate one? It was a little too icy?
That was fine. I didn't think it was too icy.
I think they're all pretty good. I mean, they're not good. I think that
they're all pretty good. They're not good.
They're fine. This is good. I mean, they're all
fine. If you got
fine.
One of those, but like you got a burger there and that's the shake you got and that was the drink, the shake you were going to have with your meal, would you be happy with that? I think in that context, you'd be a little bit like, I don't need this thing. I think having a taste of it, maybe it's okay, but I don't know. I would not want to commit fully to any of these flavors.
I didn't try the vanilla one. I gotta try the vanilla one.
Okay. Mitch is going to have the vanilla one. That was Drank or Stank, Shake or Ache edition. Just like a restaurant of our feedback, let's open the feedback. And today we have an email from Tom V. Tom writes, by the way, Tom spelled with an H. Do you like that?
No.
I don't know. I don't care for any of it.
I think it's fine. T-H-T-H-O-M.
Yeah.
No, I don't like it.
Yeah. Anyway, Tom V. writes, if you could move any holidays around, where would you put them?
Wow.
Big open-ended question. Here's the thing. There's like, I feel like there's a stretch of the year where there aren't any days off of work.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like you,
Jesus, don't worry about it.
You know what? You know what? I think the move I think it would make, I think you move, Labor Day.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't want to just move something, but because I think people should have more days off in general, but I think if you could, I would say move Labor Day to May Day, which is when the rest of the world celebrates it. And then you got another May holiday, another summer month holiday. The Labor Day weekend is fun though, but it feels like it's turned into more of a sales thing than a day off.
Here's my thing.
Mm-hmm.
New Year's too close to Christmas. Give me a couple more weeks.
It would be nice to have a little bit more wiggle room. Which one would you move though?
Oh, I got to swap it with something?
Yeah, because you got to move it elsewhere in the year.
All right, New Year's swaps with Halloween.
So Halloween comes right after.
You have to swap it. I think you can just move it to another time. Yeah, that's to be another time that a holiday exists.
Yeah.
All right. New Year's swaps to January 31st.
So January is part of the
why not?
Previous
why not
year.
In the middle of the summer?
That's actually kind of more fun, right? Right.
Summer, New Year.
Yeah.
But
it's like August
Emma,
1st?
Yo, as a New England person, isn't a cozy New Year pretty fun too?
I like Christmas's cozy holiday.
Mm-hmm.
But like New Year's, you try to go out and like do stuff, and it's always shitty weather and cold and freezing and snowing. So it'd be nice to like be able to go out and party with people and not potentially crash your car on the way there.
That's pretty good.
I'm just going to say, this is the obvious thing that's a problem. Thanksgiving and Christmas are too close together.
Right.
And thanks.
Look, we've hit the stretch. We're in the stretch right now.
So I think Thanksgiving moves to March.
Ooh, pretty good.
It's not that bad.
Good positioning in
because
the air.
That part of the year, January to March, is so fucking miserable to like put something fun in the middle of it.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah. Right after the Super Bowl, you get Thanksgiving. That's kind of fun.
Mm-hmm. Well, you got Valentine's Day in between. Spend some time with your sweetie. But
then what the fuck? Who gives a shit about that? what happens to what? But what goes on in November? There's nothing.
I think you just got a dead stretch. Still,
it is no nut November, which is it is every year, I guess. Yeah.
Halloween, but Halloween has that whole like the whole season, and then that probably bleeds into November a little bit, and then you've got a little bit more like just Christmas ramp up.
I think they should move it to March, but then also on the day that's Thanksgiving in November, I'm still gonna have like turkey and gather with friends and family.
Well, couldn't you
Does that
also
seem like it's cheating?
There is something though kind of fun of the year end sequencing of end of October it's Halloween, end of November is Thanksgiving, end of Christmas is or end of December is Christmas. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like you've like each month kind of has its own is like a land in Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yeah,
I kind of like that designation.
I think that the summer is just miss. I think the summer is missing out on some stuff.
Well, July 4th.
Yeah, but
July 4th is kind of whack. Maybe that's it.
That's kind of fun.
Yeah, there really isn't an August holiday.
Mm-hmm.
And what is in June? Memorial Day?
Maybe we should move No Nut November to August.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
That's pretty good. No Nut August?
No Nut August.
No Bust August?
No Bust August. Yeah. I can't think of an A word. Aching balls August is what I was going to say, but
pretty
balls
good.
Doesn't really work, and it's just disgusting sounding.
Well, again, bust is in bust and guster, rhyme, so no bust August.
No bust kind of. August,
to me, kind of works. Yeah. I don't know. It's not maybe not pit. It's not as sonorous as No Nut November.
Mm-hmm.
No flogust.
No flogust is good. You're going to flog your fucking rod for 31 days. There's also the added challenge because it's a 31-day month, so you got to make an extra day without flogging your meat.
I think that's fucked up.
Yeah.
Here's I got an idea. I would move. I think that June.
Yeah.
We should move January 6th to June.
Oh, God.
Can I ask a general question just about November?
Sure.
And I just want to get everyone's takes. Is edging a violation of the spirit of No Nut November, or is that okay?
No, it's okay.
You think it's okay? I think it's a violation because I think you're like trying to get away. I was like, I'm not nutting. What? It's like the I'm not touching you. Like
you got somewhere to go? What the fuck's going on over here?
No, I'm thinking.
Okay, you seem like you want to get the fuck out of here.
A little bit.
We're almost done.
I guess it depends on if you enjoy edging or not. Like, some people might find that miserable, in which case, right. I guess they can do it. But if you like edging, you're violating it.
I think so, too. I think if you're trying to get away with jacking off by just edging and not coming.
I just gotta interject here for 2 seconds. Take Susser out for dinner tonight. A steakhouse he's never been to. He made a video. Emma, did you make the videos earlier today?
Yesterday.
He made a song. Amelia saying, what the fuck did you do? Besides, interrupt my shit, you fucking asshole.
We're keeping it positive this year.
Oh, fuck you. It's me taking it. I'm making it negative this year and saying, fuck you. We love you, Sus. You do a lot for the podcast, but also fuck yourself.
If you have a question or comment about the world of chain restaurants, you can email us at doughboyspodcast@gmail.com or leave us a voicemail at 830-GO-DOUGH. That's 830-463-6844. And hey, this is the final new main feed Doughboys of the year.
Wow.
We will have unlocked Patreon episodes on Thursdays for the next 3 weeks, and then we will be back in January. But in the interim, if you're craving new content and you're listening to this and you're not on our Patreon, we have brand new episodes, including our upcoming 2023 Christmas special, every Tuesday on the Doughboys Double. We never take a week off in the Doughboys Double. 52 episodes
Sucks.
A year on Tuesday. Also, our pre-Headgum back catalog, everything from 2015 to 2018, is there as well. So at patreon.com/Doughboys, support the show and get more content.
Makes a sweet little Christmas gift or a Hanukkah gift.
Can you gift on Patreon?
Nope.
Nope.
Yeah, it's annoying.
Well, it still makes a nice gift for yourself.
You can give someone the cash value of paying
there
for
you
it.
Go. Or you can sign. You can sign someone up. You know, whatever. You can figure it out.
You figure it out.
Look, like I said, it's been a tough year for me. It's been a tough year for the world.
Mm.
But a lot of good stuff, and the podcast has been good. And I'm hoping that the world itself and things for us and the people we love and our listeners go well in the coming year. I think I'm looking positively towards 2024.
Well said. And you touched on something. And in the spirit of positivity, do we just say the podcast is good? The podcast good
wow,
now?
Wow, the podcast is good is now. Good.
Maybe Doughboys is good.
I think that it was pretty good this year.
I think it was good. Evan Susser, also good. Thank you for being here.
Great to be here, guys. As always, I had a blast. I love going to dinner. I love chatting with you guys. I love, you know, needling you a little bit, but it's all in good fun.
Yeah. Mm. Anything you'd like to plug?
Sure. I wrote on season 2 of Killing It on Peacock. A lot of Doughboys guests have been actors, not the least of which is Mike Mitchell as Dean Trovia in 2 episodes. Very funny. Claudia O'Doherty, co-created by Luke Del Turchi and Doughboys guest Dan Gore.
One of the funniest shows.
Tim Heidecker.
Yeah.
All sorts of Doughboys guests in this most recent season. Is on Peacock. It's a lot of fun, and if Dough Army gets in there, you know, who knows what could happen.
It's one of the funniest shows on TV. I had a blast filming that, and watch it on Peacock. I'm going to plug that too. I'm going to plug it with you.
And also, I wrote along with Van Robichaux, I wrote a ride at Universal Orlando that's VillainCon Minion Blast, where if you visit Universal Orlando, you can play this, you can go on this ride. That's a lot of fun.
That's awesome.
So those are 2 things to plug. And also Bosch.
Pick up Bosch.
Yeah.
And Mitch,
mm-hmm.
you have something to plug as well.
Wigs, we had to cut some stuff out of the Stephanie Beatrice episode.
That's right.
Who is a fabulous actor in Twist of Metal, the star of the show. And we have that clip. We're going to, if you keep listening, you can listen to the part of the episode we had to cut out because we talk about Twisted Metal, and now you can listen. So
there you go. A little bonus for you. A little year-end bonus. That'll be at the very end of the episode.
Check it out.
There you go.
Wait, Wags, before we end the episode, I forgot something. Yeah. I had a little gift for you.
Oh, great. We're back. There's more.
Glad
we're still doing this.
I've been through some shit. I'm dealing with some stuff.
Started 40 minutes late.
I've been trying to clear out, you know, I've been trying to clear out my... I place a little bit, get on top of stuff, waving to our next guests.
That's right.
I found something that probably was gifted to me from someone on the podcast, but
wow,
it reminded me of me and you, and I want to give it to you to have for this next year. I think you could put it on your bag. I think you'll like it. And it's Sonic dressed up as Mario.
Wow, what a crossover event. That's from Friday Pinco. Friday Pins on Instagram.
I take back everything I said. That was good. I'm glad we came back for this.
That's sick as hell.
Merry
Look at
Christmas.
That. For our, what a crossover.
Yeah. You know, a little Christmas spirit at the end.
Merry Christmas.
Did you get me something?
No.
Okay.
You don't celebrate Christmas.
That's true.
Wow. Gotta go fast. More like gotta dough fast.
Bye.
Let's a go. More like let's a dough. Let's talk about Twisted Metal. Mitch.
Now we're talking.
Stephanie, worked together in this show. You're in this show together. Tell us about it. What do we expect?
It's cool.
It's rules.
It rules.
And it's you're great
in
it.
Super violent. You're great in it too.
No, you're being nice.
I'm not.
You're cool and funny as hell on the show.
Thank you.
You don't, and it's great. I was saying this yesterday. You do a thing where you don't until the second episode. You don't say a word. This is coming out after this. Yeah. This is coming out the day. Why? Because this drops the day it comes out.
Wow.
But your performance, even when you're not speaking, is great. You do so much work just without in that first episode without saying a word.
Well, it's amazing how present you can be when you're not trying to think of your fucking lines.
It's funny because we saw a screening of the first 2 episodes last night, Wags, and I loved it. It was great. But I was watching
I heard
myself
your
off
stuff
camera.
Crushed.
Oh, that's
it
nice.
It did. It crushed.
That's. But I was looking at myself like when I wasn't acting in a scene. I was like. Like it was like a fly was like landing on my nose.
No, get the hell out of here.
But I'll tell you this, Wags, the show is great, and she's great in it, and it was hot as hell in New Orleans.
It was a lot of, I mean, it's like Demolition Derby, you know, somebody compared to like Fury Road, Mad Max meets, to me, it's very like Bugs Bunny, stupid humor. Sure. It's really stupid. It's the kind of stuff where you're in the middle of a laugh, almost embarrassed that you're laughing at it.
And Mitch is involved?
So stupid. Yeah.
All right.
Your question because there was laughs?
No, I said because it's so...
That's your tone, right? Oh, it's so stupid that it's funny. That's my tone. That's my favorite place. It's also very dark. It's like super gallows humor.
Yeah.
You know, very, very, very dark.
That's one thing I think that there's been a lot of, look, there's people who love the game and they're very protective of it. And I get that.
We both played the game.
Yeah. And so I get it. I get being protective of it. But
actually, I think the last one I played was Twisted Metal Black for PlayStation 2.
Oh, Twisted Metal Black, yeah.
Well, Ryze, I got news for you. Yeah. Twisted Metal 1 and 2 are on PlayStation Plus.
Hey, there you go.
Hey, so if you want to play,
Snip Snap.
That's on there right now. Oh. But people were like, oh, like this is going to be like, and I'm like, first of all, the show looks incredible. It looks like they spent a lot of money on it, which they did, I believe. And it's gory as hell. It's gory.
It's so violent.
Yeah, it's so violent.
It's so violent. It's like shockingly violent. I was doing ADR and MJ, our showrunner, Michael Jonathan Smith, who wrote on Cobra Kai. So it's that kind of like silly humor.
Mm-hmm.
He was like, oh, do you want to watch part of the episode? And it was the episode where you guys are in the DMV and Sweet Tooth, one of the beloved characters from the game, comes in and wreaks havoc. And like, I was like, ugh, whoa, ugh. Like, it's really, I mean, to me, I haven't seen anything that violent on TV since I watched Squid Game. Like,
wow.
It's like that. It's at that level of like, bleh, like it's gnarly.
There was a scene last night where a guy jumps onto Anthony Mackie's car. And then the gun goes up between his legs, and they just shoot him through his crotch.
His butthole on his balls.
Yeah.
But it's funny.
Right.
It's funny. Yeah. There's a joke afterwards. I don't know how to explain it. It's hard to explain to people
that
haven't
seen it.
It's very
much in the style of Twisted Metal had dark
and it's like
humor like that,
like Deadpool.
Yeah.
It's that sort of like very violent, but also really silly, goofy humor.
You know, Deadpool would like fucking some of the food we had at home state. He loves chimichangas.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Deadpool does love chimichangas. Wags is not lying.
I'm telling the truth.
We're talking about Twisted Metal.
I know. Toy tea podcast here that we're doing. Hoity toity.
But I how did you feel going to? I mean, I guess in Brooklyn Nine-Nine, you probably did some You did a lot of action.
I did a
stuff.
Little action.
It was a Fox show. Crazier stuff.
We definitely did have action. I think most of it was focused on Andy's character, Jake Peralta. You know, oftentimes the dudes get a lot more of the action stuff. It's sort of just part of the patriarchal system that we're in.
Mm-hmm.
But also, he was a lead, so I get it. But I wanted to do more. I really was like hungry to do more. And like when I heard about the series, I heard about the series through my agents, and then MJ called me and sort of talked me through it. And I asked if I could read it all. And then I read it all. I started reading it and I couldn't stop. I read all 10 episodes basically in one day. And I started reading them out loud to my sister and husband. And I was like, oh, what the fuck? Like I was just losing it.
I read them all too.
They're really good.
It's great. It's a lot
really
of fun.
It's really bizarre and weird and cool. And the world that he kind of, it's like a sort of expanded world from the games.
That was my thought about it too. Michael Jonathan Smith. He loves the games. I've been lurking on the subreddit. Why? Because I've been on the Twisted Metal.
Stay out of there.
I know. I should stay out of there. But I want to see what people think about it. And people are like, oh, they didn't do this or they didn't do that. I'm like, wait till you see. He does everything you
You've
want him to do.
You've seen a trailer.
Shut the fuck up, for God's sakes. Yeah. But I'm with you. I thought that it was – I think that the show is a lot of fun, and you're great in it. And we had some scenes together, Wags.
Yeah, we did. We had quite a few scenes together, actually.
You kind of stabbed my character in the back a little bit, I guess you could say.
You kind of deserve it.
I do kind of deserve it. I'm not like 100% a great guy, I guess, and stuff. I'm all right. But
nobody in this world is 100%. No one. Everyone is.
But we were even doing we were pushing a car. We pushed a car together.
We
did a bunch of shit.
The scenes in the well, I guess this is coming. This will be
out today
after. some point after where you've already watched it, so you won't get any spoilies. But there was like a bunch of cool locations. We shot all in New Orleans. There were a ton of cool locations.
We were at the Louis Armstrong Airport. That was wild.
That's right. The shutdown part of the airport, which was really cool. It was like very ghosty in there.
Yeah. We had to get like, didn't we? We had to like give in like our like ID information. Like it was like basically going to the airport.
No, it was like going to the airport. It was like going to the airport, except this part of the airport that no one's in.
Yeah.
That's weird.
It was ghosty.
Because like across the way, we just saw planes. There was like planes across the way. And we were down below them where like the bag. We were in like the baggage area where they put the bags on.
Like,
we saw how the sausage is made. Yeah. It was cool.
It was very cool. It was a lot of that. It was very like shooting in New Orleans is really interesting because there are parts of the city that are just they'll never kind of come back because of Katrina. And like so we shot in some of these parts of like freeway entrances that don't get used anymore. Yeah. Again, really ghosty, a lot of like ghosty feeling kind of vibes. There was a house that we shot. You didn't shoot that day, but there was this house. It was so fucking creepy. It was definitely haunted. Like, definitely haunted.
Look, I was what was the place called that I was at? I said it before. The
what are you talking about?
More specific. The hotel I was at was a
Holiday Inn Express?
No, it was the Hampton Inn.
Hampton Inn.
It was a Hampton Inn. And it was like an old building. And so the first day I was there, I was in a room that I thought was haunted in the Hampton Inn. So I was not. New Orleans is like extremely ghostly and haunted.
100%.
I felt that a lot down
the
there.
The city, it's called the Crescent City. Shitty? The Crescent City? No, it's not. I'm sorry, New Orleans. It's called the Crescent City, but it's also kind of shaped like a bowl. Like the way the city is shaped, it's shaped like a bowl. So there's this element of like, if you die there, how do you kind of climb out of the bowl?
Yeah.
Like, you know, there's like a lot of like, it does collect energy and like.
100%.
Yeah. Richard Cabral, who plays one of the characters in the show, he plays my brother. He had all these like really interesting theories about like spirits and fucking vibes and how things like stay in the city. And he was like, I gotta get out of here, man. he was ready to go by the end of his shoot.
That's truly at the hotel on the first day. I was like, this is spooky. But you guys also, they shot at a shutdown theme park.
Whoa.
It was.
That's super ghosty.
Crazy.
And there were gators coming out.
Gators just walking across the way. People were like, be careful. There's gators. There's live gators. We were like, what?
Careful now. Mind the gator. That's what they did to that for real.
Mind the gator, poor boy king.
Wait a minute. The security guard is a gator in disguise. I fooled you.
Basically.
Secret gator. Oldest trick in the book down in the bayou.
The old secret gator. But yeah, I think you're fantastic in the show, and I think that people are gonna really. I also like that the show was fun.
Having seen the trailer, it like has that great sense of fun. And I've heard this from people who've seen the episodes as well.
Fucking watch it. Trust me, for once, would you watch the show?
Yeah, you should watch the show.
You should watch the show.
It's funny and fun and like. What the fuck are you doing?
Yeah, what are you doing?
What are you doing?
What the fuck are you doing?
I know you're jacking
off. You've already watched all of Vanderpump Rules. It's also on Peacock. Just watch it.
Jack off to your boy Stu.
can I ask real quick? Can I ask about an actor I'm a huge fan of that is in the show? Thomas Hayden Church.
Oh, yeah.
Did you have any interactions with him? Did you work with him at all?
Love that guy. Many of your scenes were with him.
I thought that I was going to see him even more, and then I hung out with Samoa Joe quite a bit. But I thought that because like the first week or so,
you were ready to be best buddies.
I was so ready to be, and I talked to Thomas. He was telling me, he's like, oh yeah, I looked at your IMDb. He's like, Doughboys. He like mentioned Doughboys. I was like, what the fuck?
Why is that on an IMDb?
Because fucking our idiot listeners put it on there.
Though? Like, why is that so intense to think about him like being like, I looked at your IMDb. It fills me with fear.
He's so good. He has a presence.
He does have a presence.
But everyone, the
intimidating.
You guys, you and Nev Campbell and Anthony Mackie and Thomas. Come on,
you know
it's an all-star cast.
I had a scene where my character was supposed to spit in Thomas's face.
Oh my god!
And it was COVID. You know, like a lot of COVID regulations. We were still doing that kind of stuff before we didn't have to really anymore. And So I'm spitting like way over, you know, like way over, and it doesn't look right and blah, blah, blah. And so like, we're going to do it one more time. Like, just get a little closer, but don't really spit. I fucking spit in his face, man. I hit him right in the eye.
Oh my God.
It was so mortifying. I felt myself like melt down, and he just kept going because he's like a pro. But in my mind, I was like, I just spit in Oscar nominee Thomas Hayden Church's face.
That's
like in his face.
That is crazy.
Were they shooting his side too?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. That's so funny.
Wow. Hey. Probably looks just good.
Like, that was a pretty good spit. Happened.
He was like, he was like, for a second, he was pissed. He was like a little pissed, but then he
sure
was,
spit in your
he
face.
He was totally cool about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's wild.
He's really intimidating to. He also like.
It's interesting. Every scene that I would end after the scene, the actor would spit in my face. Which I don't know if it was connected to what we did in the scene.
It definitely
or...
was. It was about your actual personality and acting.
Wow.
Of course.
Both things. Both.
He was great and I had a blast working with him. I loved working with Samoa Joe too.
Yeah, he was great.
He was great. And you spent a lot of time with Anthony. You and Mackie were together quite
a bit. It was me and Mackie a lot of the time together, and because we're in a car, so you know, the show is basically about the haves and the have-nots, and the haves have cars.
Mm.
And it was him driving and me sitting shotgun for the majority of the shoot, and it was, you know, hot as fuck. Anthony sweats so much. He sweats so much. I don't really sweat. So the combination
of those
two things.
That's impressive, especially in New
Orleans. I didn't, but did you see me? Like, I wasn't really sweaty on camera.
You weren't sweaty, and I was always.
You were. It was hot.
Yes. I'm glad everyone noticed that. I think wardrobe at one point, wardrobe was great. The wardrobe department was fantastic. But at one point, I had like a kind of a beige brown shirt on. And they would like get a change of a shirt, and then eventually they're like, "It's just gonna be like dark brown
just leave
now."
It wet.
Yeah, just we leave it wet. And Joe was like, "They won't." They were like, "We need Joe sweaty in the scene." And then we were in his ice cream truck. Wags, this is you'll like this fact: an old U.S. Postal Service truck.
Oh, yeah.
That was redone to be an ice cream truck. Here's the crazy thing about that: no AC in a lot of those postal service trucks.
Shame. That's
insane. So it'd be like 100. It was so fucking hot in that truck. It was crazy. We would just sweat up immediately.
Yep.
Your guys' car wasn't. I don't think you guys had AC in that thing.
No,
either, right?
We had AC that was dusty and had no coolant.
Yeah.
And then we also couldn't run it during the scenes because you can't run it when you're shooting. And then finally they put some coolant in it and they turned it on and it like blew a shit ton of dust in my face. Like I took video of that. Me being like, it was not a glamour. I mean, I tell you what. You know, one of the things that always pisses me off about watching action is when the women in action have like this perfectly coiffed, like waved hair. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Like the action wave.
I fucking love that.
I hate that shit, man. I fucking hate it. And so the first day in the makeup trailer, in the hair makeup trailer, I was like, look, I'm not usually a diva, but I am going to be a diva about this. I want to look dirty. I want to look like it's the post-apocalyptic time this is set in. I want to look like my hair hasn't been washed and my face is kind of scrungy. Mm-hmm. I want to look like I took the end of a match, burned it, and then like rubbed the soot on my eyes as makeup. And that's what they did. That's how I look.
I love
the
it.
Series.
That's and that's how you're supposed to look.
You're supposed to look like
I was telling you earlier that
fuck.
We watched the first two episodes last night. Again, I've already said that, but I was saying to you like the thing that was harder for me to watch is like, I was like, oh, I kind of just look like shit. But that's what you're supposed to look like.
You have to look like shit, man.
You're supposed to look like shit. Is there any – does your character interact with any food? Because, look, it's a food podcast, Wise.
Yeah.
I'm trying to tie it back to food. Mm. I'll say this.
Love that.
When I make up my appearance on the scene, Wise, I am food. I'm about to be eaten.
That's right.
And then Anthony Mackie also eats a seal. But do you have any food interactions?
Oh, we have a whole scene that's in a burger joint.
Yeah.
We had a whole scene that was shot in a burger joint. An abandoned burger joint. In the show, there's like a sect of people that have decided that the second coming will be the burger lords, sort of.
Like
not
that.
The restaurant
like
in Highland Park.
We should sign up for it. Yeah.
But we're trapped in this like we're sort of trapped in this burger joint, and we find a couple burgers in the freezer along with maybe some bodies.
Oh yeah.
And we eat those burgers, and
well,
and we shot for quite a while in that burger joint. It was. Hot in there as well.
This brings up a good point. Wags, you should tell her your thing about human flesh, if you wouldn't mind.
You would eat it.
I would eat human flesh. Anytime I've read first person accounts of eating a person, they have said like it is like the sweetest meat.
Oh my God.
So I wouldn't want to go out of my way. But if it was like, hey,
no, hold on, he wouldn't go out of his way.
But if it was a situation where it's like, hey, this is a person.
Unbelievable.
You want to eat some? Right. Try it.
I try to warn you that the podcast is bad and we're both weird.
God, that's so funny. Fuck. Oh my God.
Also, in here's a question.
How did that even come up in your conversations? When were you like, so would you like eat a calf?
I think that he honestly just brought up cold turkey.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Hey, Mitch.
No.
I'd like to eat a person.
here's they get served on the show. They get served white tiger because mm-hmm. they're at a casino. And
that was gross.
Was the actual meat gross?
It was actual white tiger and it was disgusting.
Wow.
It was just like slightly undercooked because I needed to look red.
Sure, yeah.
And I'm like a very much, I gotta have my steak well done. I know it's not the way that's supposed to happen, but I gotta well done my steak because my mom would undercook steak or overcook it and it just fucked me up for life. So
yeah.
So in that scene where I look, I'm really, that's some of the best acting in my career. Like, I was like,
you're mortified?
Yeah, I was not having it, but I look like I am.
That was great acting. Acting throughout. Would you eat white tiger?
If cooked properly.
If cooked,
I think so. I think
if
I would.
Prepared for properly. You. All right, you would do it.
I mean, we've been in a situation, I try not to eat meat in general, but if we're in a situation where we're sharing food and you're like, I'm going
to
throw out the rest of this.
I try not to eat meat in general, but I'd eat a human being.
I'd eat a person.
Here's the problem. This is the problem. You are starving yourself for meat, and now you've got a taste for fucking humans.
Yeah, I think that's what
is
happened.
Is that what happens?
I think that's what happened.
All right.
You and Sweet Tooth would get along great.
It is an awesome cast. I mean, like everything I've seen looks really great. Obviously, a ton of funny people are in it. A ton of funny people have written for it. We're part of the writing staff, been past Doughboys guests. And people should check it out. All episodes are on Peacock. Anything else about the show that we missed? Anything else you want to cover?
No, you should watch it. Did we say that?
I think one of the things I think I'm excited for people to see is how smart it is. I mean, I know it's very dumb, like dumb humor. But there's a very, the writing staff on that show doesn't dumb things down. It figures that you are smart enough to figure out the story behind the story. And I prefer television that doesn't assume that I'm an idiot.
Sure.
And I think this is that kind of TV. Like, you're caught up in this fun story, but you're also, there's like a little sense, your little sense in the back of your brain that like, maybe this is about more than just this. This is kind of like about what we're living right now.
Yeah.
You know?
Kind of the opposite of the Doughboy stance where we think our listeners are dumb as fuck.
Yeah, there's cars in it, you fucking idiots. You like that, right? Like people driving around, fucking fighting, you dipshits. Check it out.
You're right. It's analogous to the bad world we live in in many ways. But it's great. I think people don't know what it is yet and are like, who's in the middle of the show? I think they're going to be blown away and be blown away by you and you're so funny and great.
That's real nice. That's real nice.
It's just the truth.
Thanks, friend.
Well, congrats on the show.
Thanks.
And I'm excited to check it out myself.
You better fucking watch it.
I will watch it. You think I'm going to watch it? I support my friend's projects.
All right. That's enough.
Bye. Hey, buddy. It's Weiger. Breaking Chews. Get Played, the video game podcast I co-host with Heather Ann Campbell and Matt Apodaca, is now right here on HeadGum. Listen to Heather, Matt, and me, Wigs, talk about good games, bad games, and every game in between every Monday. Get Played on HeadGum. Subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Wow. Sources for the intro are in the episode description.
That was a HeadGum podcast.